It is a beautiful Saturday morning, and it will be a beautiful Saturday afternoon for football here at Elliott Field on the campus of Fitchburg State University. And a beautiful day is fitting, as it is senior day here at Elliott Field. I'm John Gugerty, joined as always by Dan Bolek. Dan, senior day, independent of anything else, always one of our favorite games of the year.
Of course, you know, the last home game for the senior class, especially for the senior class that has had to endure so much over the last few years.
Obviously, you look at the records coming in. It's Fitchburg State versus Westfield State, both teams coming in with records of 0-9. If you look at it just like that, for these seniors, their senior season, an 0-9 record, try to get one win to go out with, that would be important enough. But then you think back about the struggles Fitchburg State has had in the years leading up to 2020. And of course, you know, 2020 happened. These guys missed an entire season of playing time last year. It really is one of the more special senior days we've had here. And also, Dan, just a very winnable football game against an 0-9 Owls team of Westfield State University.
Yes, one of the coaches we were talking to earlier in the game said this is basically our Super Bowl. I mean, for these two teams coming in having struggled throughout the campaign, both of them 0-9, both of them have experienced gut punch losses to Worcester State. For Westfield, that was just last week, their 33-30 loss to the Lancers, in which Aaron Moses Williams found Kevon Davis in the end zone as time expired on a 41-yard Hail Mary. So both teams, you know, they've had their battle scars throughout the season, but today, it all comes down to today, trying to avoid the wooden spoon. One of these teams is going to go home with the trophy nobody wants, and the other team will have a victory on their ledger.
And Fitchburg State will do everything in their power to make sure that they are not the ones going home with the wooden spoon. They want to get at least one season to end what has been a very difficult season, and they look to get it against Westfield State University. We take a look at the Owls offense, Dan. They will be led by their quarterback, Peyton Capizzi, and a running game, kind of a two-headed monster there, O.T. Thomas and Lee Colon in the backfield for Westfield State. Tell me a little bit about what Fitchburg State can expect from these Owls.
So Westfield has had, a bunch of different personnel that they've rotated in and out throughout the season. Capizzi is listed as the starting quarterback for today's game, but Gabriel Fernandez actually got the majority of snaps last week against Worcester State, 20 for 27 for 258 yards, 3 touchdowns. And Lee Colon was the lead running back last week, although not listed on our two deep today. But that's never stopped players from being spectacular on the field.
Absolutely.
And yes, as we mentioned, Shane Clark as well. He's a senior, 38 carries for 102 yards on the campaign. Colon, 73 for 263 on the season. O.T. Thomas, 361 yards, and Lee Colon actually had 132 yards and 2 touchdowns the last time he faced off against this Falcon team 2 years ago right here at Elliott Field.
And speaking of touchdowns, Dan, one thing I notice as I look just at the 4-deep roster that you put together for Westfield State, I don't see any rushing touchdowns here for the Owls. It has been, you know, you would expect with an 0-19 some troubles scoring. Westfield State coming in averaging just over 10 points per game. That's the 8th worst in all of D3 football. Of course, if you're talking about scoring woes, we would be remiss not to mention that Fitchburg State comes in averaging almost half that total, just over 5 points per game. They are the worst of all 240 teams in Division 3 in terms of putting points on the board. But, you know, at the same time, both of these defenses have conceded a lot of points on the season. I think we're going to see some scoring today. This is my hot take, Dan. Both teams in double digits today.
Yes, I think this is going to be a game in which these two teams should be fairly evenly matched. I think Westfield does have the advantage coming in. They've definitely been on a little bit of a run lately. The first 5 games of the season, they were not able to get into double digits. But, you know, they had a respectable 26-16 game against a 7-win UMass Dartmouth team. They had a 17-7 loss to Plymouth State, in which Plymouth put 36 on the Falcons. And then the Worcester State game, you know, both teams were very competitive in that game against Worcester State, and it took really heroics by the Lancers to come away with that. And I am now looking at the roster for Westfield State to see how many rushing touchdowns they do have, and they do have a couple of rushing touchdowns. Interestingly enough, they're not from players who are listed as quarterbacks. Peyton Capizzi has two on the ground. Anthony Centrone, a wide receiver by trade, has one. And Gabriel Fernandez, that quarterback we mentioned, has one as well. But yes, the players who are designated as running backs in the roster do not have any touchdowns.
Something to keep an eye on for Westfield State. Again, it is senior day here at Elliott Field. We'll see, probably, Dan, I would think we're going to see a lot of names deep on the depth chart that maybe, you know, maybe weren't figuring into the starting offenses, especially for Fitchburg. But keep in mind, this is also the last game of the season, the last game of the senior year for Westfield State as well. So I would think, you know, we're going to see a lot of names that we don't often see. One name we might see is Linnea DeKeel. We've talked about her in the past. We actually heard that Fitchburg State does plan to get her involved if scoring falls the right way. So we'll see about that.
Of course, after all, she proved herself to be a more than capable kicker a couple of years ago. She was 7-for-8 on extra points. Matt Kimball got the kicking job this year, the transfer from Becker College, and he's been perfect on extra points and has kicked a couple of field goals. So it's one of those challenging things, but you know, she's just as capable, and we're going to look forward to see her try to get into this contest today.
Absolutely. There will be 8 seniors, I believe, listed as being honored today for Fitchburg State University. You see the Falcons there taking the field. They will be in their all-green uniforms. Westfield State on the far side. Looks like they're going to go, I believe I saw them in the white tops, Dan. Is that about right?
Yep, white tops and I believe the white pants. I may be forgetting by now already because I wasn't paying full attention when they came out on the field a little while ago.
Well, you know, it's not like that's our job or anything.
It's our job when we're on the air.
Exactly. And we're on the air now, so we have to sound like we know what we're doing. We are going to step aside right now and hand it over to public address announcer Dr. Robert Hines as he walks you through all of the Senior Day festivities here at Elliott Field. It is a very important day here on FATV. We're so happy to be here. It is Senior Day here at Elliott Field.
Let's recognize first the seniors of the Fitchburg State cheerleading squad. Nicole Epstein, a severe special education major from Bow, New Hampshire. Okay, Bo! Victoria Fuller, a business marketing and management major from Tewksbury, Massachusetts. Madison Fitzgerald, a human services major from Ashby, Massachusetts. Olivia Sullivan, an early childhood education major from Beverly, Massachusetts. And Calista LaFave, an exercise and sports science major from Leominster, Massachusetts. Ladies and gentlemen, your senior cheerleaders of the Fitchburg State University cheerleading squad. And now, let's honor the senior student athletes from the 2021 Fitchburg State University football squad, beginning with Joelle Montero. Joelle has been a 2-year member of the Fitchburg State football team, serving in a primary role as a defensive back. Joelle has totaled 70 tackles on 47 solo tackles, 23 assisted stops, 2 sacks, 4 tackles for loss, 7 passes defended, and 1 interception over his 18-game career. This season, Montero has collected 35 total tackles on 25 solo stops, 10 assisted tackles, 2 tackles for loss, and 3 pass breakups over 8 games. For the green and gold, ladies and gentlemen, number 2, Joelle Montero. Joseph Haskins has been a 2-year member of the Fitchburg State football team, serving in a primary role as its quarterback and punter. Haskins has thrown for 337 yards on 33 completions and one TD pass, while also rushing for 109 yards on 76 carries and three touchdowns. In addition, Joe's hauled in eight passes for 70 yards, as well as netting 2,984 punting yards. This season, Haskins has passed for 337 yards on 33 completions with a touchdown, while adding 109 yards on the ground with three scores. Averaging 31.6 yards per punt in seven games for the Falcons this season, ladies and gentlemen, number 14, Joseph Haskins. Timothy O'Neill has been a two-year defensive back and wide receiver for the Fitchburg State football team, seeing action in 15 games for the green and gold. Over his career, O'Neill has totaled 16 tackles on eight solo stops and eight assisted tackles, as well as one pass breakup, while also catching five passes for 61 yards. This season, Tim has hauled in five passes for 61 yards, while adding one solo tackle over seven contests for these Falcons. Ladies and gentlemen, number 17, Tim O'Neill. Mac Kimball has been a one-year member of the Falcons football program, serving a primary role as the Falcons kicker. This season, Mac has also caught three passes for 16 yards, while going 2 for 2 in field goal attempts and adding six extra points. Ladies and gentlemen, number 19, Mac Kimball. Mukandu Ashima has been a two-year member for this Falcons football squad, serving in a primary role as a defensive back. Over his career, he has appeared in 17 career games, collecting 74 tackles on 42 solo stops and 32 assisted tackles, as well as 2.5 sacks, 3 tackles for loss, 2 forced fumbles, and 4 pass breakups. This season, Ashima has notched 35 tackles on 19 solo stops and 16 assisted tackles to go along with 2.5 sacks, 2 tackles for loss, 1 forced fumble, and 2 passes defended over his 7 games for Fitchburg State. Number 25, Mukandu Ashima. Rodney Bonholm has been a 1-year member of the Fitchburg State football team, appearing in 8 games for the green and gold from the defensive back position. Rodney has registered 39 tackles on 26 solo tackles and 13 assisted stops, as well as 1.5 sacks, 3.5 tackles for loss, 1 interception, and 1 pass broken up. Ladies and gentlemen, number 29, Rodney Bonholm. Linnea DeKeel has been a 2-year kicker for the Falcons football program, appearing in 6 games for the green and gold, while going 7 for 8 on extra point attempts, including her first collegiate extra point on October 12, 2019 against Framingham State. Ladies and gentlemen, number 43, Linnea DeKeel. John Galvin has been a 1-year member of the Falcons football program, appearing in 3 games for the green and gold on the defensive line. Galvin has registered 1 solo tackle in limited action while contributing to a Falcons defense that has averaged 63 tackles per game. Ladies and gentlemen, number 65, John Galvin. Fans, these are your 2021 senior student athletes. Congratulations.
Congratulations once again to all of the senior student athletes and cheerleaders being recognized here at Senior Day at Elliott Field here on FATV. Again, one of the most important games of the season, irrespective, Dan, of the records of these teams. But at the same time, it's an 0-9 team versus an 0-9 team. You know, we've already said this is kind of like the Super Bowl for both of these teams.
Yep, and like even if it was, you know, a 2-7 team taking on a 7-2 team, this game would still be just as important in regards to how meaningful it is for the seniors how rewarding it is to have their families come out, have everybody ready and supporting them, having been through this for so long. And for these two teams, you know, they're going to leave it all out on the field today because, you know, can't hold anything back. This is over, like, years of trials and tribulations that these sides have gone through. And for Westfield State, you know, they had a handful of seniors on their roster. They've got 17 in all. And their senior day didn't quite go to plan last week. And so they're going to want to exact a little bit of revenge on this Fitchburg State side.
Yeah, for their seniors, it's like, well, we lost at home on our senior day. Why don't we go to your place, beat you on your senior day, and also we'll end our senior season with a victory. So, you know, definitely some, I don't want to say spiteful motivations for the Owls, but, you know, it's a football game. It's a contest. Both teams are trying to win, and just because it's a special day in Fitchburg doesn't mean Westfield is going to roll over and play dead, you know? They're going to come here. They're going to play hard. And as you said, Dan, they may well be the better team. You know, they've put up, you know, obviously they haven't won any of their games this season, but they did score, you know, 16 against UMass Dartmouth. They just put 30 on Worcester State last week. You know, Fitchburg State scored 13 points last week. Those were the first 13 points they had scored in six games and a second of football. So it's going to be a tough task for Fitchburg State here at Elliott Field.
But it'll be all the more rewarding if they can come away with the victory.
While we have a moment, we want to thank our underwriters who make this and every remote production possible here on FATV. Dan, why don't we go ahead and do that?
Indeed, FATV Remote Productions underwritten by Workers' Credit Union, Rollstone Bank and Trust, UMass Memorial Health, Health Alliance, Clinton Hospital, North End Subaru, Unitil, Minuteman Press, and the Sentinel and Enterprise. We thank them for all the support they give us.
Absolutely. We also want to let you folks at home know that Fitchburg Access Television is your local access TV station. If you live, work in, go to school, or are a member of a Fitchburg organization, you too can become a member of FATV. Membership brings many benefits, easy for me to say, and gives you access to all of FATV's equipment, including cameras, audio and lighting equipment, edit suites, studios, and so much more, including the newest addition, the FATV Podcast Suite. We offer technical training classes to teach you how to create your own program. You can reserve channel program to channel time. I haven't done this ad read in a while. You can reserve channel time to broadcast your program to the Fitchburg community and beyond. Visit FATV.org for more details and start producing your own show today. Captains are heading out to midfield. Fitchburg State's captains are Joe Haskins, Joel Montero, and Makondo Ashima.
And for Westfield, it's Shane Clark and Peter Spinelli. Just two captains for the Owls.
Had a bit of a discussion today with Dr. Hines, being like, who are the Westfield captains? Because we couldn't find it listed anywhere, but it's Clark and Spinelli. Looks like Westfield has won the toss. They're deciding what to do with it.
So it looks like Westfield has deferred and Fitchburg will start with the football.
So we will see the Falcon offense up first as we get ready for senior day here at Elliott Field. We'll step aside for the national anthem, but don't go anywhere. It's College Football Saturday right here on FATV.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, we ask that you please stand if you are able as we honor America with the playing of our national anthem. Thank you.
Fitchburg State University football live on FATV from Elliott Field on the campus of Fitchburg State University. I'm John Gugarty, joined as always by Dan Bolak. Dan, looks like the Falcon offense will get the ball as we get ready to start play.
And I'm really interested to see how this offense is going to run against this Westfield State team. As we mentioned, the Owls have struggled a little bit this year in terms of rushing defense. They've given up 182 yards a game on the ground.
A lot of teams with some pretty big leads against Westfield State have been able to run the ball, run out the clock at the end of the game. We'll see if Fitchburg's able to get some movement going on the ground. They really seemed to have something, Dan, last week with big Justin Stanford coming out of the backfield.
Yes, and of course, Stanford's not going to be a guy who's going to be able to run the ball every single down over and over again. You know, 6 feet tall, 270 pounds from Warrenton, Georgia, but he looked pretty good last week in that role, and I'd like to see how he can do against Westfield today. TJ Wade also will be looking to contribute on the ground game for the green and gold as well.
So Christian Julian set to kick off for the Owls. They are in the white and white. Julian, the left-footed kicker, gets this one away. Taken in at about the 12-yard line. That's Ben Palazzo, goes straight up the middle, gets some pretty good blocking, and he's out to the 38-yard line. Fitchburg State's offense will have pretty solid field position as they take over first and 10.
I've mentioned, you know, for as many challenges as the Falcons have had this year, special teams is not really one of them. They've got solid kick returners there. Ben Palazzo is one of them as well, along with Jordan Dickerson. Both of them have done very well in the kick return game this season.
Falcon offense comes out first and 10. They're led by their quarterback, Joe Haskins. He, of course, is a senior. We mentioned Justin Stanford. He is in the backfield on first down. Rather hard to mistake him for anyone else here in this Falcon backfield. First down handoff. There's flags at the snap. It's a pretty big gainer here for the Falcons, but I suspect it's coming back. Haskins kept it himself, but there were flags right at the snap. Dan, I think maybe Matty Ayere was moving toward the line of scrimmage at the snap, and that's what they're going to get the Falcons for.
One of those things, you know, they've put Aguirre in motion. This is a play they've run throughout the season where they put one of the slot backs in motion, maybe try to make the other side jump. And in this case, you know, I don't know if Westfield jumped in this particular circumstance, but he was moving, and they didn't do the fake out like they have in the past.
Officials took a long time deciding what they want to call, but we'll see.
Defense, number 99. That penalty's declined.
Noah Juar was called for offsides on that one, so that play is going to count.
It's a free play for the Falcons. It's good for a Fitchburg first down. You see right there, Juar jumps as Ayere goes into the backfield. He's in the neutral zone at the snap. So that gives it a free play for the Falcons, and it's a good gain. Fitchburg State is already into Owl territory. First and 10 at the Westfield 45. Now they take a pitch. They're looking to throw it here, but blown up in the backfield. Mack Kimble was going to get rid of that one. Instead, he was swallowed up almost immediately by Peter Spinelli, one of the captains on this Westfield State defense.
I think this is a play that I've sort of referenced throughout the season as something they could possibly do because Mack Kimble has quarterback experience from Becker College, and he wanted to throw that one. But of course, Spinelli got there so quickly, he just never had a chance to get the ball off. It looks like about a 10-yard loss.
It's a huge loss. But you could tell as soon as Kimble took the pitch, he really didn't sell the fake at all. He wanted to throw it, but Spinelli was right there in the backfield. So now it'll be first and 20 for the Falcons as they're back in their own territory. Kimble tries to throw to the left side. That pass is swatted down by Cade Nelson. Nelson, a sophomore from Shrewsbury, did a good job getting his hands up there. So Dan, Fitchburg State had that one big play on their first play from scrimmage, but now two disasters here. They see third and 20.
They wanted to pass immediately, and again, it was just a challenge of trying to contain Cade Nelson just bursting in and throwing his hand up and rejecting that ball.
This Fitchburg State offensive line has had troubles all season. Troubles with injury as well as just quality. Now on third and 20, play fake by Haskins. Pass to the near side is incomplete. He was looking for Kimble. He very nearly found Cullen McNeil, the junior from Northbridge. McNeil jumped on that route, knocked it down. May consider himself unfortunate that he wasn't able to make the interception. Take a look at it again, Dan.
So of course, trying to do the play action there. And on the throw to the right side, you see him jumping the route there.
Julian is set deep for the out.
Cullen McNeil, he's already forced a turnover this season, although doesn't have an interception to his name, the junior from Northbridge, but still someone to watch there on defense for the Owls.
Haskins gets away a pretty good punt. It's going to bounce at the 20, take a Falcon roll, and it'll be downed inside the 15-yard line as the ball switches talons, so to speak, one set of birds to another. It'll be Owl football, first and 10 at their own 15-yard line.
So the Owls, they did have themselves a boatload of offense last week, 533 yards of offense they were able to put up against Worcester State.
You mentioned Gabriel Fernandez, the freshman, took the majority of quarterback snaps last week against Worcester State. He's back there now. He has Shane Clark to his left. It's Clark, the ball carrier, on first down. Really not much doing there. Gets across the 15, short of the 20. I think they'll spot him at about the 17. It's a gain of two.
Fernandez is a freshman. He is from Holyoke, and Clark from Bellows Falls, Vermont, a senior. One of the 17 seniors, as we mentioned, for Westfield State.
Fernandez just a freshman, but he's a big guy, 6'1". Second down pass is incomplete. It was a little bit low. Did hit his receiver in the hands. He was looking for Danny Farrell.
Intended for Danny Farrell. Farrell's a favorite receiver of this Owl team. 31 catches on the season is Danny Farrell. No touchdowns for the sophomore from Milford.
It's a low pass. You know, it's one of those passes where, yes, the receiver got his hand on it, but it's hard to say that he really should have caught that. It was a difficult pass. Now on third down, Fernandez rolls to his left. There's a flag down as Fernandez has a ton of space in front of him. I think those two facts may be related. As it is, Fernandez ducks out of bounds with an easy first down run, but we will check the infraction.
The last time we saw an easy run in this contest, the infraction turned out to be irrelevant to the grand scheme of things. But this one feels a little different.
Yeah, this one came from behind the play from the defensive backfield. I think maybe the back judge saw a hold or a block in the back.
There's no flag on the play.
No foul. So there is no foul, and once again, we see a big run by a quarterback that looks like it might come back, but then does not. So Westfield State gets a first down. They're moving. Mark the ball out to about their own 37-yard line. Call it a 20-yard run for the quarterback.
His long run of the season coming in today was 10 yards, so there's a big jump there.
Now Clark gets it running to the left side on first down. Lowers his shoulder, gets across the 40-yard line before being brought down. Couple of Falcons there, Dakota Lucero and Joel Montero.
They were the first two to arrive. Saw D. Jones getting in there as well.
Montero, of course, one of the, actually a graduate student, but we saw him being honored before the game. Lucero is a junior. Now on second down, Fernandez will keep it himself, running to the right side. He's got another big hole. It's finally hit at the first down marker, but that's going to be enough to stop the clock and move the chains, and then a flag comes out well after the fact. I saw a Fitchburg player looking very upset as he was getting up. We'll see what the call is.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct. On the offense, number 87, 15 yards from the end of the run. That's number 87's first unsportsmanlike conduct penalty of the game.
Joseph DeBlasi, the sophomore tight end, guilty of unsportsmanlike conduct. We'll take a look at it here. Comes well after the play. And Fernandez, I mean, maybe he's upset with the hit to the quarterback, but that's perfectly fine, totally legal. Okay, what are you doing there, Joe? You can't do that. You're punching the man. Don't punch the man. No wonder he's upset. If I was Torian Wise, I'd be upset too.
Ball may have been on the ground there.
Looks like a rough exchange there. Westfield State did fall on it. Lee Colon was there.
And we already have more fumbles in this game than we had last week.
Looks like they were trying to get the handoff to Clark, but he never got it. Fortunately, Colon was there. It's a loss of just a yard. It'll be second down and 11 for Westfield State.
make the Owls think they can exploit the flanks a little bit. If they can get the ball out there, they can get some big yards.
Fernandez pass to the near side is complete. Brought down at about the 45-yard line is Colon. That's going to be enough for a first down. And yeah, Dan, pretty much everything from Westfield State has been going to the edges. We really haven't seen, you know, their first play from scrimmage was a run up the middle. Other than that, it's been a lot of quick passes to the outside, quarterback keepers, sweep type runs, that sort of thing.
I guess that's what they feel that they can exploit. Fitchburg being a little soft, and you can see Colon bouncing out to the near side and gets a good chunk of yards on first down.
Even on a play like that, Dan, that's a run. It's designed to be a run up the middle, but the option is there for the running back Colon to bounce it to the outside, and that's just what he does. Fitchburg State not able to keep contain. It's a good gain on first down for the Owls. They're into Falcon territory.
Lee Colon, just like Gabriel Fernandez, a graduate of Holyoke High School.
Second down and two for the Owls. Another fumble. This ball is rolling into Fitchburg territory. Nobody wants it. I think the Falcons say they have it. And they do. Fitchburg gets a big break there. A turnover by the Owls. Fitchburg State will have the ball.
Just another bad exchange, and that time, you know, I think one of the challenges was that, you know, some of the players were trying to just pick the ball up and run it, trying to scoop and score it, as opposed to just jumping on top of the football and trying to haul that in.
Yeah, you see right there, I mean, this is one of those plays where it's like footballs are weird and they bounce weird and it's going all over the place. You see right there, Montero is trying to scoop it up rather than fall on it. Dakota Lucero at the bottom of the pile is able to just scoop it up. So now first and 10, Falcons at their own 47. There's a fumble. Westfield State saying that they have it. Who's got the ball at the bottom of this pile?
Fitchburg has it.
Goes back to the Falcons. Frank Sims was there. He was able to fall on it. Sims has kind of fallen out of favor in the running game over the past few weeks. I'm sorry, Dan, go ahead.
Yeah, that's, I think, his first carry in a few weeks. Well, let's see, since the UMass Dartmouth game. So his first carry in a couple weeks. He already has 6 fumbles in the season and 4 lost, and you can now make it 7 fumbles. But
I was going to say, I seem to recall that part of the reason Sims may be falling down the depth chart is issues holding on to the football, which, yeah, those are still present.
We didn't see him last week. We can see they've changed up the formation a little bit as they've moved both their slot backs to the right side.
Now Haskins keeps it. Think he was running the option that time. Decided to keep it himself rather than pitch it back. He might have gained a yard. But he was bent over backwards as he was tackled there.
So we already mentioned last week how ball security was something that both teams greatly believed in. No turnovers, no fumbles last week. At no point did it look like the ball was loose. This week we've played 6 minutes of football and the ball's come out 3 times.
That is true, yeah.
And Fitchburg State leads the nation in fumbles lost. That's a stat you don't want to lead in.
No, absolutely not. Here on third down and 11, Haskins is taken down. Just no protection at all for him. This time it's Cameron Danahy getting into the backfield, the junior from Kingston. Came from the defensive right side, and he was just completely unblocked. We'll take a look at it again.
Haskins is literally no chance at all. He drops back and he's already under, and he's basically wrapped up immediately.
Yeah, he barely has time to set. He's already in trouble pretty much from the moment he takes the snap. Westfield State's defense bringing the pressure, and Fitchburg's O-line hasn't been able to stand up to it. Haskins gets away another pretty good punt. So bounce at the 30, go out of bounds at about the 26-yard line. There is a flag down. Flags at about midfield, so maybe a blocking foul by Westfield State trying to set up the return.
Our sources in the press box say that flag flew a tremendous distance.
It's true. Let's see what this one is. Theoretically, we'll see what this one is.
They're already marking off against the Owls.
Personal foul on the receiving team, number 18, blindside block. 15 yards, from the end of the kick. Correction, half the distance to the end of the goal from the end of the kick. First down.
Connor Schlittler, the freshman, guilty of a blindside block as he was trying to set up the return for the Owls. So that'll march Westfield State, Dan, all the way back to their own 13-yard line, give or take, where they will take over.
The Owls did a fairly solid job at moving the football on their first drive. The challenge was just holding on to the thing as Lee Cologne blows a tire on first down.
Looked like he tried to revert. I think, Dan, this was a case where the play was designed to go to the outside, but Cologne saw a hole up the middle, tried to reverse direction. We'll see it here. See, he's going to the outside, nothing there, tries to cut back up the middle and just loses his footing, and he goes down after a gain of a yard.
Also note these autumn leaves on the ground might lead to issues with traction in this contest.
That they might. Here on second down, Cologne takes it to the outside, however. Gets close to the line to gain. I think they're going to spot him a line to about a yard shy. D. Jones had the hit for Fitchburg State.
Brings up a third down, and Westfield's had two today. They've converted on both of them. As again, they're going out to the flanks. That's where they feel they can do the most damage, and so far, that's where they've been doing the most damage.
Fernandez under center on third and one. Hands off straight up the middle. Plunging forward is Clark. He didn't need much, so the fact that he didn't get much doesn't really matter. It's enough to move the chains. So far, Dan, the only thing that's been really capable of stopping the Owls' offense is, ironically enough, the Owls' offense.
They've been doing a solid job moving the football. And really, the only other things I could say about it are just going to be me repeating myself over and over again.
First and 10, Westfield State from their own 24-yard line. Falcons bring a little bit more pressure. Fernandez wants to exploit it, going long to the outside. That pass is incomplete. Looked like he was trying to hit Connor Schlittler there.
Intended for number 18, Connor Schlittler.
Pass was just a little bit out of Schlittler's reach, though. We'll take a look at it again.
Westfield is a team that I think is far more comfortable passing the football, 158 yards through the air this year compared to just 87 a game on the ground. But we've been seeing them do a little more running today, and even the passes have been relatively short.
Second down handoff, Clark bounces it out to the outside. He's got a big gain. He's into the Falcon territory, across the 40-yard line before finally being dragged down at the 30. That is a big, big run for Shane Clark, one of his longest of the season. Probably his longest period.
Clark's longest run of the season was 12 yards.
This is more than 12 yards.
Yeah, I mean, I wasn't looking through my binoculars at the start of the play, but one thing I immediately noticed is that far side of the field just did not have nearly enough green shirts.
First and 10, Owls in Falcon territory now. Clark goes straight up the middle, plunges forward for about three, and a flag comes in after the play. These are two 0-9 teams who may be venting some frustration today, and that's not a thing you can really do. You can hear the Falcons sideline admonishing their players, you know, play football, man, come on. It's a direct quote. Slamming into each other after the play doesn't really count as football.
No room for those shenanigans. We want the last game of the year to be memorable for good reasons.
Unsportsmanlike conduct on the defense, number four. The penalty enforced half the distance to the goal, automatic, first down.
Dakota Lucero is the guilty party. We're gonna see what happened at the end of the play here. So yeah, right away from the play, Lucero's just shoving a guy as he's down. You can't do that. Gabriel Velez, you know, good job by him. He got up and he got into Lucero's face, but he didn't return physicality. So there were no, like, offsetting penalties are there. He just, you know, expressed his frustration. And now we get whistles before the play. Looks like everybody's all set to go now. First down handoff goes to Clark. Tries to get something going to the right side. Not much there.
Short game.
Looks like Rod Bonhomme, among others, were there. Bonhomme's another senior. We saw him honored pregame.
Bonhomme coming today with 48 tackles on the campaign. Very solid for the senior.
Sebastian Burmester was there as well with the hit. It's a gain of a yard. It'll be second and 9 for the Owls. Fernandez looks to pass. Goes to his left for the end zone. It is incomplete. Just a little bit too tall. He was trying to find Anthony Cintrone, the sophomore from Auburn. Cintrone had just a little bit more height. He might have been able to bring this one in. But you see the pass sails just a little bit too high on Fernandez. It was also well covered by Gary Spears. I'm sorry, Dan, go ahead.
Threw that ball like a rocket. That's what I wanted to say there.
I really do think Westfield State has something here in Fernandez. He's been pretty darn impressive on these first two drives.
And just a freshman as well.
Now on third down, they play fake, pass over the middle is complete, wide open in fact, and diving across the goal line, touchdown Owls. Danny Farrell with the catch. And just like that, Westfield State has taken the lead.
First strike to the blue and white. On the play action, just the quick throw over the middle. Farrell's able to get it and just get those last few yards bouncing off a couple of Falcons. And he's going to stay on the field, I presume, to kick the extra point.
Farrell is indeed the kicker.
But they're not going for that.
It's an interesting formation here. They try to get it with Clark, and he is stuffed.
Yeah, the players set up like they were going to do it in a sense. They had the holder, and they had Farrell back there. And they just, you know, the holder does not get into position, and they just decide, oh, we're just going to run the play now.
Yeah, they just do a direct snap to Clark, try to keep the Falcons a little bit off balance, but nothing doing there, so it is only a 6-0 deficit for Fitchburg State, but a deficit nonetheless. As the Owls draw first blood, they lead 6-0 with 5:21 to go here in the first quarter.
Well, at the moment, let's do the out-of-town scoreboard. Although I think this is the most relevant game in the MassCAC today, since Framingham already won the MassCAC title with their win over Bridgewater last week. Mass Maritime is hosting Bridgewater State in the Cranberry Bowl. Framingham State hosts Worcester State. Plymouth State hosts UMass Dartmouth. And we saw Westcon last week. Their season is over with a 5-5 record. And those games all starting at noontime, so every game starting at the same time.
That's always nice. You know, I like it when the EPL does that. You know, Major League Baseball has done it in the past couple seasons. That's very cool. Every game on the last day of the season should start at the same time. That's cool. Julian kicks it away. This one's a hooked kick. That's going to bounce at the 20. It might have gone out of bounds if he waited for it. But of course, you can't wait forever for that. Return takes it out across the 20-yard line to about the 22-yard line for Dickerson.
Yep, and let us also note that the Falcons have been burned by that once this season.
That is true. I think that was the opening kickoff of the season, wasn't it?
Yep, against Castleton, in which the ball should have gone out of bounds and just a gust of wind at the wrong time kept it in bounds long enough for Castleton to recover.
So now Joe Haskins will lead the Falcon offense back out onto the field. He'll have Justin Stanford in the backfield. Falcons still rotating guys in and out of the rotation here. I mean, I suppose that's what you do with a rotation. You rotate it. Motion to the near side. It's a handoff to Stanford, and he is driven backward. It's a whole pile of people there.
They actually had not given it to Stanford on the first two drives of the contest. And so on the first play, they tried to give it to him. Westfield had sold out to it, basically.
Might have been a little bit like Westfield State knew what was coming there. You know, big number 98 comes in the game. Makes sense. It's a loss of just a yard. It'll be second down and 11 for Fitchburg State. Now they try the pitch for Kemp for 15, excuse me, and he's dropped down.
Tiago Palma.
The ball carrier.
First time we've called Palma's name in a while.
David White,
the tackle for the Owls. We'll take a look at it again. Mentioned the Falcons are getting a lot of different guys in. I thought it was initially Kimball and they were just going to rerun that toss pitch pass play, but no, it was Tiago Palma. He really didn't get much there. White was there along with Cade Nelson. It's actually a loss of a couple. Fitchburg State's going the wrong way. Third and 13, Haskins under pressure immediately, and his pass to the far side is incomplete. He was trying to find Jordan Dickerson. He did find the turf about 3 yards in front of Jordan Dickerson.
Yeah, Westfield just loading up the box right now with seven guys and just pressure, just hard pressure on the snap to overwhelm the Falcons' O-line. Doesn't give them a lot of time to really do much of anything.
You saw there, great camera work actually. You saw Cullen McNeil just coming from that left outside linebacker position. He was unblocked until he was nudged by the running back, but by that time Haskins was already feeling the pressure, already had to get rid of the ball, and it wound up falling well short of Dickerson, and Fitchburg State's offense goes three and out.
And the play clock ran out.
Well, that's not a good thing. You don't want that. We'll see if the Falcons will be penalized or if maybe they called a timeout before it expired.
Reset the play clock to 3 minutes.
So I think they're just going to reset the play clock and not assess the penalty. Fitchburg State will kick it away. Well, presumably. They do have their quarterback back there as the punter, but they'll kick it away. This time it's a returnable kick taken in at about the 45-yard line with some good running room in front of him. Finally jumping out of bounds after a very good return.
It's Christian Julian, who we saw already handle the kickoffs for the Owls. He is also a punt returner for the blue and white and had a 75-yard punt return earlier this season.
How often do you see that, Dan? Even at D3, kicker and punt return. So it's interesting.
Julian by trade, I believe, is a receiver.
Listed as wide receiver. Actually, he's listed as a safety. But, you know, he does a little bit of everything. And this time you see he's got a huge hole on the right side. Nobody wearing green until he's almost at the sidelines. Owls will have excellent field position here. First and 10 at the Falcon 25. Fernandez back to pass. Maybe wants it all. Nothing there. He's going to take it himself. There is a flag. I think maybe they're going to get the Owls for holding here. Right now it's a 10-yard run for the freshman QB. Go ahead, Dan.
Yeah, the hold would definitely have been one of those things that didn't help Westfield, because by the time that flag flew, Fernandez had already found that space on the far side.
So a couple of different flags there. I did see a pile of players at the line of scrimmage. You know, at some point, a functioning offensive line just kind of turns into a grab people party, and you don't want to have those.
Holding offense, number 41, 10 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
Lee Cologne guilty of the hold.
From the spot, they'll mark 10 yards off. And because of how late that flag came, it erases a few yards of Fernandez's
first
run.
And 18.
Winds up being a first and 18. And it's going to be second down and more than that as Cologne is driven backward. He ran pretty much right into the waiting arms of Cam Manette.
Cam Manette able to blow that one up in the backfield.
Freshman from Winchendon, the Blue Devil, bursting into the backfield. He had that read properly.
That he did. It'll bring up second down and 23, it looks like? Something like that?
22, they're saying. And the handoff
second
there.
And
it's like, but that would have driven him all the way back to the end zone if he didn't hear the whistle.
Yeah. He could have just kept driving back if they would let him.
Second down and 22 for Westfield State. This time Cologne runs out of the grasp of Manette. He's got a pretty good gain, close to the original line of scrimmage. I think he's gonna have the distance to gain. It's a gain of 11. It'll bring up third and 11. It's a very impressive run by Cologne, Dan.
Halfway there and half to go. Yeah, they're making this run game work, Westfield is. Obviously, the books have implied that the run game has been a struggle for them this year. They're already over their per game average.
They give Cologne 10 yards, so it'll be third down and 12. Gotta think this is four down territory for the Owls. As we approach the 2 minute mark here in the first quarter, play action pass to the near side is incomplete. A big hit delivered. A big hit by Mukando Ashima. I don't think it was solely responsible for knocking the pass loose. It was already going to be a difficult catch. Take a look right there. Anthony Cintrone, Dan, you could see him like extend for the ball and then kind of coil up as though he knew the hit was coming. And it came.
He knew he was going to be in for a world of pain there from Makondo Ashima.
Fourth and 12.
The Worcester native. The big, big hit.
Now fourth down and 12. The Owls do indeed go for it. Fernandez lobs one up to the far side. That is incomplete, but there's a flag down. I think Dakota Lucero got a little bit aggressive with his coverage there. Might have just been a lofted up to the sidelines and see what happens type play.
Now, some discussions on what exactly they want to call here.
Holding, defense, number two. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Since the ball crossed the line of scrimmage, the penalty includes an automatic first down.
So Joel Montero is guilty of the defensive holding, and because it was on a pass play, you see it right there. That's I think they called number two, but I think it was actually Lucero. Because you saw right there, it was Lucero number four who was guilty of the hold. And because it was a pass play, the ball was beyond the line of scrimmage, they give an automatic first down as well. So first and 10, Owls from the Falcon 18-yard line. This time,
I believe it was Smith,
the ball carrier.
Gain of about two on the play.
Only picked up a couple. Actually, excuse me, that was Cologne.
Second and eight.
Like I said, they do try to run up the middle occasionally just to try to keep the Falcons honest, but they've got the middle read pretty well.
Second down, eight for Westfield. Hand off left side this time to Cologne. He is spun down and dragged backward after a gain of about five. It'll be third down.
Burmester. By the Fitchburg State
Sebastian hit. Burmester, the tackle for the Falcons, among
about
others.
About three on the play.
It's third and manageable will be, and again, as I mentioned, the runs up the middle, we're getting a few yards.
Third and four.
But it's the runs on the outside that have done far, far more damage.
Third down and four now for Westfield. This is right about where they were when they hit that touchdown pass. This time they hand it off to Cologne. He goes straight up the middle. He's got the first down, but not the touchdown. Stop the clock, drop the chains. It'll be first and goal for the Owls inside the Falcon 5. Looks like we'll get maybe one more play here in the first quarter.
That time, you know, just spreading out the box a little more just because you got to respect the pass, especially as you mentioned how they scored a touchdown from that spot, essentially. And that gave Cologne enough room to work with.
First and goal, Smith gets the carry. He's not going to get there. Actually,
Shane Clark, the ball carrier.
Logan Shane Perez Clark was the ball carrier. Getting up a little bit slowly is Gabriel Velez, one of the offensive linemen for the
Second
Owls.
Goal.
But he looks like he's okay. He's going to try to stay in there. And Dan, they will take the long walk all the way down to the other side of the field. As we've reached the end of the first quarter with Westfield State leading Fitchburg State by a score of 6-0.
Since that very first play from Joe Haskins, that run, everything else has been going south for the Falcons offensively as they're now credited with minus 5 yards of offense while Westfield 151 yards, 127 of them on the ground. For a team that only averages 87 a game on the ground.
I've got to say, Dan, if you're a Fitchburg State fan, and presumably a lot of folks watching are here on Fitchburg Access Television, you have to feel a little bit lucky that you're only down 6-0 at the end of what has been a very dominant first quarter for the Owls of Westfield State.
Yeah, maybe it's just a matter of they've been going to Gabriel Fernandez more and more, but he definitely seems like the better quarterback between him and Peyton Peasy, who was the senior gunslinger for the blue and white. Fernandez coming in with a pass completion percentage just under 60% for one thing. He's shown that he can run the football. He's fairly comfortable doing that. He's got 39 yards on the ground. Clark 7 for 57, most of them coming on that 46-yard run.
We want to let you know that in addition to our live streams on the internet, you can now watch FATV programming in stunning high definition on your Roku, Fire TV, or Apple TV devices, or through our apps in the Android and Apple app stores. Download the free app today, and to learn more on how to watch FATV programming, go to fatv.org/watch-FATV. That's fatv.org/watch-FATV. And now with play-by-play action, as we get ready for the second quarter of action here from Elliott Field, here's Mr. Dan Bolek.
Owl's second and goal.
Owl's 6 yards from goal on second down. Fernandez is going to float it up to the left side and into the end zone. It will go for a touchdown.
Jamar Johnson with the catch. This is one of the simpler play designs you'll ever see, Dan. You've got a bit of a height mismatch on the far side. You just take the shotgun snap, you throw it up there. You've got Johnson matched up against D. Jones, and D. Jones is a great defender. He's been a great part of this Falcon defense, but Johnson is several inches taller, and that matters.
Extra points up by Farrell, 14:55 to go, second quarter. It's 13 for the Owls and not for the Falcons.
Johnson listed at 6'2", D. Jones listed at 5'7". You don't have to be a math major to know that that's a mismatch, and down at the goal line, you just throw it up high, let the taller guy go get it.
And put it in a place where the defender can't get to it. And Fernandez with a second touchdown through the air today, his sixth of the season.
And again, Dan, I've been really impressed with the play of Gabriel Fernandez, the freshman from Holyoke. Mentioned he took over midseason from Peyton Capizzi, and he has really given this Westfield offense some spark. They look, I mean, quite frankly, they look a lot better than Fitchburg.
Yes, especially since Fitchburg has just been discombobulated with the defense, but it just comes down to just how they have not been able to stop anything on the line.
The running game, especially the outside running game for Westfield State, has been so good. It's opened up opportunities through the air, and Fernandez has taken advantage of it.
Dickerson will haul that in around the 10-yard line, try to blast it up the middle. Going to get to about the 25-yard line and not much farther than that. As he gets wrapped up there by Joel Perez Guzman.
Saw Ethan Russell come out of the pile with a little bit of a demonstration. I think Westfield State is feeling themselves right now, Dan, and it's hard to be mad at them for it, but they know the way this game is going. Let's put it that way.
Through the first 15 minutes and change, they know they are the better team in this contest.
Of course, still plenty of time for the Falcons to turn that around as Joe Haskins and the offense comes back out for another possession.
So, as we mentioned, after that 16-yard gain by Haskins on first down, the Falcons have had minus 21 yards of offense. Got to turn the momentum and tide back in their favor. Haskins will keep it himself after faking the handoff to Stanford on first down, try to replicate that success. He bounces himself out to the near side and gets a very solid gain of about 5 or 6.
And we talked a little bit about it last week when they had that success with Stanford. It's just for the way the Falcons are right now, they need to find one thing that kind of works. And once you have that, you can build off of something else. And maybe it is, you know, Justin Stanford straight up the middle. If Westfield State respects that enough, they can build a play action off of it like they did there.
Stanford will burst up the middle. Bounces off of one of the Owls and then to the ground. That was Joseph Dumoulin standing strong there against the 6-foot-tall, 270-pound cannonball.
Chains are moving. That's a Fitchburg first
That's
down.
That's pretty much all it is, Dan. It doesn't look like much, but because he's lined up so close to the line, it's a first down.
The Falcons get right back to it on the pitch out to the far side on first down.
Matthew Aguirre.
Matty Aguirre makes the tap, makes the run for the Falcons, gets a couple.
Falcons try to keep the momentum going. They rushed up to the line as soon as they were ready to go. This time they sent Aiyere in motion. Got some pretty good blocking. Tried to cut it back toward the middle. Didn't really get much there, but hey, a gain of four is a gain of four. Nothing wrong with that.
And considering the struggles the Falcons had in the first quarter, they'll take a gain of four. Second down, six to go. Stanford still in the backfield. Gire with that stutter jump there. It's going to go up the middle this time. But Owl swarming in there, pushing the Falcons back.
Stanford ball carrier.
You mentioned that stutter jump by Aguirre, Dan. That's something the Falcons have done a couple times. I almost thought, you know, on the first play of from scrimmage, and again right there, you might see an officiating crew get him for moving toward the line of scrimmage there. He really isn't, but it's very close. It has to be timed just right.
Third down and five to go. Falcons have to get to their own 44-yard line. Aguirre goes in motion behind Stanford. Haskins will pass rolling out. He wanted Tim O'Neill. Ball well in front of him and a defender in the way as well.
Are you sure he wanted O'Neill? Because I thought he was floating it for Stanford there. There were two guys in the area.
Fourth down.
O'Neill's who I saw in my binoculars, but let's see what the camera looks at. Unless you're thinking, you know, Stanford behind the play a little bit and it was badly overthrown for him.
It's hard to tell if it was overthrown, intended for Stanford, or a little bit too far leading O'Neill. There were, like I said, there were a couple of different Falcons in the area there, so.
And Haskins wasn't able to find any of them. But a testament to Westfield just putting him immediately under pressure. Haskins is going to throw on fourth down, and it's going to be complete to Torian Wise, and that's going to be a first down.
Always got to watch the fake punt when the quarterback is the punter. We've seen it a few times from the Falcons. This time it's good enough to move the chains, get the punt team off the field, bring the offense back. Falcons still have the football.
Just gets the quick throw off to the right side. Torian Wise Jr. able to wrap that one in and get the yards he needs. Falcons will keep the offense on the field with that first down.
And I tell you, Dan, if that was a punt, Ethan Howard was going to block it because he came in completely unblocked. But, of course, that was the design. Get the defense thinking they're going to have something and then say, no, actually, we'll be keeping the ball for ourselves. Thank you.
Under 12 to go, first half, 13-0. Here's Stanford with a 10-yard gain.
Nobody wants to get in front of Justin Stanford when he's got a head of steam. You called him a cannonball. This is more like a boulder rolling downhill.
First down yardage for the Falcons.
A little bit of mobility there. Cuts into the right side. He gets it again here.
Doesn't get as much this time, but still a very respectable 4 yards on first down.
Dan, do you remember watching Dan Dierdorf call football? When guys like Sam Adams or Vince Wilfork would get the ball, he was so happy. Dan Dierdorf would love watching Justin Stanford run.
Oh, yes, and Stanford brings the Falcons now 39 yards from goal. They're making progress. Second down and about 7 or 6. Stanford again goes up the middle, and he's lost the football somewhere in there. Lots of stuff has happened. Westfield ended up with the football. I have no idea what's happened. And there's a flag.
Cameron Danahy came out of the pile with the football. I don't know if that means if he picked it up off the ground. He was pushed down well after the fact. So I think the best case scenario for the Falcons here is that they will keep the ball, but it will be 3rd and 20. Instead, it is going to be Westfield's football.
Westfield State has recovered the fumble.
So let's take a look at it again. Stanford goes straight up the middle, and just somewhere in there, he just loses the handle, and it's gone. It's already gone. It's out of frame, off to the right side. It winds up in the arms of Danahy.
The fumble recovered by Westfield State.
Take a look at it again here. Somewhere in there, it just gets stripped out. You can actually see at the bottom right corner of your screen, it's obscured by number 99. But yeah, as we back this up just a little bit, you can see at the bottom right corner of your screen, God, I wish I had a telestrator, but right at the bottom right corner there, you can see the ball is already loose. picked up by Westfield State. Fantastic work, as always, by the FATV crew. Just a great job by the guys in the truck. Thank you so much for that. So you've got the turnover, and then on top of that, it's a 15-yard penalty on Fitchburg State because of the shoving after the play. So Westfield State is going to have the ball deep in Falcon territory, or at least over midfield in Falcon territory, first and 10 to the Owls. And I'm going to take a breath.
Westfield offense first and 10.
Penalty against somebody, obviously. Couldn't hear it. But that'll be for Jamie and Betty Ann to sort out. It's 48 yards from goal, our Westfield State looking to make it a three-possession game. The Owls' offense have been challenging to stop in this contest for Fitchburg. They've really gotten their second wind as the season has gone on. First down, it's Clark rolling to the right side, shakes off that tackle, and a second one. Takes a third man to bring him down, and Ashima. And because of all that running parallel to the lines, he only ends up gaining 1 yard.
He gained one, but he could have lost three or four. He had Rod Bonham bearing down on him. Take a look at it again. He's lined up as the left back, but it's a designed run to the right. He's got the lead blocker, but right there, he's able to shake Bonham, and he gets 5 or 6 yards back. Turns what could have been a disaster into a short game.
Second down, 9 to go, shotgun, two backs, fakes the handoff, throw is complete up the middle. Lee Farrell again, he's down at the 30-yard line. Another big gain for the Owls.
We've talked a lot about how the running game has been working for Westfield State. This time they go play action. You get the running game established, and then the defense has to respect the run. They bite on the play fake. It opens up space for Farrell.
Now a run out to the left side. And wrapping him up and taking him down as Aoul Saint. It was Justin Jean Charles, the former Falcon, who got the handoff there on that down. But there is a flag on the play.
Aoul Saint had that tackle for loss for Fitchburg State.
As the flag is yellow as the autumn leaves that surround Elliott Field.
Not to mention as yellow as the blinding sun.
Personal foul, chop block on the offense. Number 55 and number 63. 15 yards from the previous spot. First down.
And as much as the Falcons appreciated that stop there by Lusaint, they will happily take the result of the infraction of the chop block. It'll be minus 15, it'll bring up second and 25.
Second and 25 or first and
25? First and 25. Because sometimes words come out wrong.
Assar. 9.5 minutes to play here in the first half. Owls lead this one 13-0.
So it'll be first and 25. First and 25. Ball backed up 45 yards from goal. Again, out of that formation, three receivers, two to the right. And Fernandez steps up a little bit, does get the pass off. That is complete on the near side. Cordell Parrish, the junior from Everett, pulling that one in and then fighting for yardage, eventually forced down in or out of bounds.
Gained about 10 of the 15 yards that were lost back. So Falcon very gingerly heading off the field here. Can't quite see who it is. Looks like that is Rod Bonham. So one of the senior leaders on this Falcon defense. So slamming his helmet down and marching down the sideline trying to walk something off.
Definitely a lot of frustration for him. Doesn't want to leave the game here on senior day. Clark will have the handoff, goes to the right side. But again, it's like if you can't get that clear of the tackles, essentially, it's a little harder to get the yardage. It'll get a few, though.
Bring the Owls a little bit closer to the original line of scrimmage. And again, you think this is going to be, you know, you would have to think this is four down territory for them. They're kind of in that maroon zone. too close to the end zone to really punt. And with all due respect, very few kickers at D3 are going to hit a 50-yard field goal.
Farrell's hit from 24, and this is not 24.
No.
4-6 on third down today are the Owls. Fernandez already scrambling, finds a hole up the middle. There's nobody around anywhere near him right now. And he doesn't even receive contact till he's past the 20-yard line.
There is, however, a flag in the backfield thrown by the referee. Not going to say that's definitely holding, but in a situation like that, it's almost certainly holding.
There's a period of time where it just becomes academic.
Holding. Offense. Number 63. 10 yards from the previous spot. Repeat the down.
Gabriel Velez guilty of the infraction this time. It'll be a 10-yard penalty that negates the first down run by Fernandez. Danny, he's not your traditional, he's not a super fast, ultra mobile quarterback in the mold of, say, Jeremy Kimber back when he was running the offense for the Falcons. But Fernandez has a little bit of mobility to him. He's, again, I've been really impressed with his play so far. It's going to be something to watch for Westfield State over the next few years, is the evolution of their freshman quarterback, Gabriel Fernandez.
He's played tremendously well today, and now under pressure. Hit as he throws, and it's going to be incomplete for Cinthron. Cam Monette able to fight off the Owls and able to make contact with Fernandez as he threw.
You said it, Dan. Fernandez was feeling the pressure from Monette coming from the right side. We'll see it here on the replay. He beats his block right there. Fernandez isn't able to set his feet. He's got to lean back, put a little bit more into it than he might have wanted. Cintrone unable to get to it. After the penalty, Dan, that actually backed the Owls up enough that they're going to kick this one rather than go for it on 4th and 22, which, I don't know about you, but I'm not feeling 4th and 22.
Nah. Don't think the surrender index will be too angry for that.
No.
So we'll
Can we make Taylor Swift jokes this week, or will Jake Gyllenhaal be mad at us? You think he's just hiding somewhere?
I've got no Taylor Swift jokes that I could make. But
I've got one. It's doing numbers on Twitter.
All right. Well, actually, let's do an out-of-town scoreboard.
Sounds like a plan.
So in the Cranberry Bowl, the 42nd annual Cranberry Bowl, Mass Maritime up on Bridgewater State 7-0. MassCAC champion Framingham State leading Worcester State 15-0. 9:25 to go in the second quarter there. And UMass Dartmouth has 20 on the board against Plymouth State with 6:15 to go in the first half there. Plymouth State has won 5 in a row. Their winning streak started with their victory over Fitchburg State in week number 5. Shane Clark is the main punter for the Owls, and he averages about 31 yards punt.
I don't think they're punting this one, Dan. Oh, there it goes. Saw somebody march up to the line of scrimmage, start barking signals, thought maybe they were going to try a fake here.
And it looks like Westfield's pinned him deep.
Touchback.
Nope.
No, he hasn't. Thought he had for a moment.
Came very close, as they tried to get that one in just inside the end line, but no, it went across the goal line rather. Touched by a player who was in the end zone, so it is a touchback rather. Now I have a question for you, Dave.
Okay.
You mentioned the Cranberry Bowl.
Yes.
And here in Fitchburg we have the Chicken Bowl, the Turkey Bowl. Is that like a mashed potato bowl? Gravy bowl.
Someone should invent one somewhere.
Green beans bowl.
I also believe the Cranberry Bowl in the past has been sponsored by a certain beverage involved with cranberries.
I would hope so. It seems like a natural occurrence. I am a canned cranberry sauce man. I don't know about you.
7:11 to go. First half. 13-0. Westfield in front. Haskins at quarterback. Stanford in the backfield. Take it on first down, tries to spin out of a tackle as the line had been breached, but Spinelli, I think, was the first to arrive, and Cullen McNeil as well for the Owls will stop Stanford's progress.
So it's going to be interesting for Fitchburg State as they bring the offense and Justin Stanford back on the field. I think there might have been a little bit of a confusion at the snap. Haskins kind of moved a little bit further to the right than Stanford was expecting, and they almost collided with each other at the moment of the handoff. So that's something to watch. But also, just in general, you've got a converted defensive lineman as your tailback. Ball security is going to be a factor. There were no fumbles for him last week, but on that last possession, he put the ball on the ground.
They're going to say he didn't get the playoff in time. It was tremendously close. That's what I feel it is. It could have been someone jumping just because they saw the play clock so low.
Delay game, offense, number 14.
Yeah, I can tell you they gave no tolerance for that one.
That was basically the moment it hit zero, look at the ball, if it's not moving, blow the whistle. So the Falcon offense coming up with new and original ways to go backward, which is not the kind of creativity you'd hope to see, but you know.
They didn't break the huddle until there was, I think, 12 seconds in the play clock.
Seems bad.
Just not paying enough attention there. Stanford will try again. Try to get to that far flank. Gets about a yard, and then there's some disagreements after the play.
Heard a bunch of groans here from the press box. There were a number of Fitchburg State employees who thought maybe the Falcons were going to be called for another personal foul, but I think Ryan McDonald got away with one there.
Let that one go. Stanford just trying to make his way to the far side, but again, you got to beat all that Westfield defense there first, and that's a challenge in of itself.
And actually, Dan, there on the replay, you saw a little bit of a shot to the face delivered right at the end of that play by a Westfield State player, so it's coming on both sides now.
Haskins wanted to throw. He will throw. That one is low and incomplete. Wanted to find Dickerson on the far sideline. With how low that was, even if Dickerson had hauled it in, it would not have been good enough for a first down.
Once again, gets to third down. Westfield State brings the pressure. This time Haskins is able to escape to the far side, but as you said, Dan, the pass to the sideline is low. You can see right there, the sticks were a good 3-4 yards further downfield. So even if Dickerson had been able to bring that in, it would not have been a first down.
Play clock's winding way down again. But now they gotta wait for the ball to be spotted. Now they've spotted it. So it will be a punt from Haskins. Julian will take it in on a bounce. Shake off one tackle. Devin Currents will be the one who will wrap
Julian
him up at midfield. Good field position again for the Owls. 5:01 to go. First half, 13 for Westfield, not for Fitchburg.
For the Fitchburg hit. Owls,
I'm not feeling terribly good about my pregame prediction of double-digit points for both teams, Dan. You're not going to lie.
Yeah, Falcons are having trouble getting the gears going here. Westfield's matching up against them quite well. Owls with 189 yards of offense, Fitchburg just 49.
Talk about Fitchburg not having the gears going. I don't think Aguirre's gotten a single carry, has he?
Here's Lee Cologne on first down, and he's got himself a lot of yardage. To the near side he goes.
Lee Cologne with a nice game.
Well into Fitchburg territory. Gain of about 14 yards.
I think he might have almost gotten 15 more yards at the end of this one. I think as we see here on the replay, as Perez has taken him down, Dan, does he grab him by the horse collar?
That was what I thought on first blush.
No, I think he's got jersey there. I think that's a legal tackle.
Close. Another run for the Owls, and feet churning, ball continues to move.
Lee Cologne
with another good run for Westfield. Fitchburg just not getting the matchup that they were hoping for.
Joe DeBlasi, one of many Owls, providing some good blocking there for Cologne.
Second and three.
A 7-yard gain for Lee Cologne.
You see there, even as he's being wrapped up, he's got two or three of his offensive linemen just plow into him from the back and shove him forward for another 3 more yards.
And Fernandez calls his own number this time. And a yellow handkerchief has been thrown onto the field.
That's Sarah, odd.
Why would a person do that?
Because he feels that the ball should be in a different spot on the next play.
Would that perhaps be because one of the gentlemen on the field is not playing football in accordance with the rules and regulations as agreed upon by both sides?
It could very well be the case.
My
personal
goodness.
Foul, face mask, on the defense, number 25. The penalty will be enforced half the distance to the goal.
Donovan called for
automatic
face mask.
First down.
And you can just give Westfield half the distance to the goal from there, and they're ever closer to getting their third score of the game.
This has been a very hanky-happy first half of football. Is that fair to say?
Good chunk of penalty yards in this game. That was the
The gentleman just throwed a yellow handkerchief on the field.
I was about to say that was the ninth penalty in this contest. Now we have the 10th penalty in this contest.
There have been a few plays that flags were thrown that wound up being no foul, too.
That's happened as well.
Well, you know, it's the last game of the season for the officiating crew as well, maybe.
Yeah, potential playoff assignments.
That's true.
There's no foul on the play. Fitchburg State.
So there's no foul here, but we're going to take a look again at the last penalty, the face mask against Ashima. It comes right at the end of the run. You see right there, he goes back and grabs the top of the helmet. He's got a hand on the top of the helmet. I think it's legal to have a hand on the top of the helmet, isn't it?
Yeah, did not grab.
The umpire is right there. The umpire is 5 yards away from that. How do you...
Yeah, because he's put his hand on the crown of the helmet. I guess it's natural to think that the fingers might be reaching in underneath there.
I mean, okay, but if you're 5 yards away from that, it's frustrating. I'll leave it at that. It would be understandable if someone was to go back, look at that, and take a look at it again. He's not grabbing the face mask. He just has his hand on the top of the helmet. And I suppose, and maybe this is just devil's advocate here, if you've got your hand on the top of the guy's head and you yank back, the guy could still break his neck.
Yes.
And that's probably bad.
Yeah, it's still a reasonably dangerous maneuver. I don't think that was Makondo Ashima either, because that one's digit looked like a four.
Yeah, probably.
Well, it was somebody.
It was somebody. It got called. It gives the Owls some more yardage.
It's one of those things that even if you didn't do the illegal act, don't do an action that looks like the illegal act.
That's true.
Or people will say it's the illegal act. This is Cologne trying to run on first down. Stayed on his feet somehow and got himself an extra couple of yards.
You want to know how somehow is somehow, this isn't the entire somehow, but part of the somehow is that one of the Falcons has got Cologne by the ankles right here. And then Andrew Winningham is just going to go try to strip the ball out rather than go deliver the tackle. You see him reaching in there trying to pull the ball away from Cologne rather than deliver the tackle. Cologne was able to lunge forward and get a couple more yards.
Second down. Fernandez throws. That's going to be caught. See the receiver makes the catch, runs back towards the line so that he can try to gain a little more yardage by running around the tackles. That was Anthony Cintron who made the catch. I think that was his first catch of the day. Indeed it is. That'll be his 17th of the season.
Fernandez was looking to the left side the entire way that time. I think maybe he was thinking about going to the end zone, but he checked it down to Cintron coming out of the slot. Got a good gain, but not enough for a first down. It'll be 3rd and 4 for the Owls. They can get a first down without scoring a touchdown.
Owls 4-for-8 on third down today. Fernandez looking to his right. That one knocked up in the air and incomplete. And cross with himself was D. Jones, feeling he probably could have brought an end to that drive right then and there.
Was trying to find Owen Thompson for a second. I thought the ball was going the other way. And Dan, the most remarkable thing has happened. A gentleman has thrown a yellow handkerchief onto the playing surface again.
Indeed.
Hold it.
And so the Falcons are going to take the penalty here because 4th and 4 from the 7 feels like that's going for territory or field goal territory. In fact, that's a distance that we already know that Danny Farrell can hit from. And so march them back another 10 yards. Give them third and 14.
Al's third and 14.
But if they can't come up with a first down on this play, then
the question becomes, do you feel comfortable kicking a 35-yard field goal?
Or going for it on fourth and whatever it ends up being. Blowing the one back. Gonna go with that short dump-off pass to Cologne. Didn't get as much protection from his line as he would have liked. And doesn't get much, if anything, at all.
Loss on the play.
Tried to set up the screen here. Logan Perez had it read very, very well. Luke Noyes was there as well. See, Fernandez dropping back. He's trying to invite the defense to come get him. But it's a good job by Perez and Noyes. Or, as our camera operator Kayla would say, Mr. No-Yes, to get to him.
Fitchburg calls a timeout with 2 minutes to go in the first half, and that brings us to the fact that we haven't thanked our crew today.
We have not. Let us do that. Our director today is Nate Glennie. Travis Falk running audio and graphics for us. Todd Govan handling replay. And our camera crew, Robin Como and Jared Roberts up top. Moritz Vetter and Kayla Jorgensen down on the field. Thank you so much to them. Fantastic work, as always, by the crew here at FATV.
Of course, got to have great coverage here for Senior Day as well. These two teams, you know, last game of the year, not going to see them again until next September, essentially. Westfield State, Fitchburg State, for my count, 36th meeting between the two teams. Westfield's won 25 of them, Fitchburg 10, and Westfield's won the last three.
You mentioned, Dan, that we won't be seeing these teams again until next September. I feel like it's going to be a very different look for Fitchburg State next September. I would be surprised and quite frankly disappointed if we see the same offensive philosophy that we've seen from the Falcons this season carry over into next season. I think there's going to be a lot of change over the coming months.
I think that's going to also come down to the personnel that comes in, whether as freshmen, transfers, or otherwise. We're going to put 5 seconds on the clock.
5 additional seconds. They're not going to set it to 5 seconds. That would be bad.
Yep.
Be weird.
5 seconds on the clock in addition to the two already there. 125 ticks of the clock.
Fourth and 16.
Owls will go for it. Why not? It's Fernandez stuttering around, looking for a little bit of space. Going to throw deep left side, and that's far too deep.
Dan,
Fernandez,
the most remarkable thing has happened. A gentleman has thrown a yellow handkerchief onto the playing surface. There's also a hat. I understand the hat. But the yellow handkerchief is now officially a running joke.
At this juncture,
is it bad when it becomes a running joke in the second quarter?
And it's holding against Fitchburg, which is awful.
That's not good for the Falcons, no. That could be especially terrible. We've already seen one defensive holding lead to an automatic first down today.
Holding. Defense, number 25. Penalty will be 10 yards from the previous spot. As the ball crossed the line of scrimmage, penalty includes an automatic first down.
Kondo Ishima is the guilty party. Referee said 10 yards. I think he's going to say, actually, hold on half the distance. But the more important thing by far is the automatic first down.
So first and goal from just inside the 10-yard line, it'll be.
Al's first and goal from the Fitchburg 9.
Willie Cologne bouncing out left side. He's got room to run. He'll find the end zone. And I think,
Dan,
I just saw another yellow handkerchief.
The most remarkable thing has happened. A gentleman has thrown a yellow handkerchief onto the playing surface.
It is holding against Westfield. Glad I saw the flying yellow handkerchief before I could even say it was a touchdown.
Holding. Offense, number 18. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Remains first down.
Anybody getting a Framingham State flashbacks right now?
Yeah, that was the drive.
So the penalty is on Connor Schlittler, number 18. He's lined up at the top of the screen here. I think it's right there. You actually saw it happen as he's running past him. He's just got a big handful of green jersey. And you wear white, Connor. You can't grab the green guys like that.
They don't like it so much.
So now first and goal from the 17, is it?
It's something of that nature, since they didn't mark off the whole 10 yards, because it's 10 yards from the spot, and he was well past the line of scrimmage at that point. Cologne, on the adjusted first down, gets a couple of the yards back.
I tell you, this has been a remarkable drive, just for
second
the sake case that, you know, Westfield has been down at this end of the field for what feels like a decade at this point, and they've been able to run down a lot of clock as we get near to the end of the first half. They might actually need to start taking their timeouts at some point.
And they get the ball to start the second half as well. I think they heard you.
Am I psychic? No, the Falcons are psychic. Okay. Okay. It still counts. I'll still take it.
It took a timeout. There was zero on the side of the scoreboard that said timeouts, but I guess one of those timeouts that was taken earlier was a Westfield timeout, and whatever. So 1:12 to go, first half. Fitchburg State 0.
Westfield State 13.
Yes, it is.
Folks, we want to let you know that there is so much to watch on your community access station of FATV. You can check out quality FATV programs such as Barbara and You, Inside Fitchburg, Chess Chat, Forks Over Fitchburg, and Discussing Fitchburg Now. Of course, Fitchburg Access Television also covers a number of incredible local events, you know, Memorial Day parades, Civic Days when that is a thing, hopefully once again, a number of local sporting events. You know, we're getting into the winter. Not saying it's going to happen next week, but you know, hockey, maybe some basketball. We'll see. We'll see. There's lots of stuff to watch here on FATV, is the point. And oh yeah, don't forget to follow FATV on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram as well.
So there have been 12 accepted penalties in this contest, and okay, we've seen, you know, a few declined penalties, and we've seen two in which there wasn't actually a penalty at all. And it's like, those yellow handkerchiefs were on discount.
It feels like it.
Buy in bulk, it's always tremendously smarted.
Dan?
The most remarkable thing has happened.
The gentleman has thrown a yellow handkerchief onto the playing surface.
Illegal substitution. Substitution on the defense, 12 men on the field. 5-yard penalty.
Pittsburgh correction called for the Canadian defense.
Remain second down.
Not in this country.
No. 12 men on the field. Now, okay, it's illegal to have 12 players on the field. Let's see if we can count it for the Falcons. You got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Second, I count 10. This is not the entire defense. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I count 10. But again, not the whole shot.
Cologne just trying to get his way into the end zone. Can he do so in a legal manner?
I did hear a whistle. Side judge comes in. Okay, you got multiple guys raising your hands here. One guy with the ball, you don't count. No, the guy in the stripes raising his hand is like, put the ball right here. So that's where we're going to put the ball.
The important thing is he did not get in. It's third down and goal to go. He'll just try to punch it in this time. Fernandez backpedaling his way into the end zone. Touchdown, Owls.
It is just so hard as a defense when it is, you know, goal to go inside the 1-yard line. Even if you know it's coming, when the quarterback takes the snap, he knows where he's coming. You have to react. Already there, he's across the line. There's very little the Falcons can do once they don't get that initial push. And Westfield State's into the end zone for the third time today.
Farrell to set up for the extra point. And it's blocked. Loose ball. See if the Falcons can try to bring it back for two. They'll have a go. Torian Wise just trying to run parallel, get away. And he can't get there, but it keeps that point off the board. And it will stay 19-0. And Wise, the way he got wrapped up, probably went down a bit awkwardly.
Westfield State has had some troubles after scoring their touchdowns, Dan. They went for two on the first time, didn't get it. Now they have an extra point blocked. Could see, I think it was maybe Cam Manette who got his hand on it. and then Wise just picks it up, tries to make something happen. See maybe what happens to him. Yeah, he's just grabbed by the right leg, and then somebody falls on him as he's getting down. And then you see he gets right back up and then realize, oh, no, that hurts. I really shouldn't do that. And he is still down just now, getting to his feet, is Torian Wise. But he's going to head off under his own power. We'll keep an eye on him. Hope he's able to get back into this one.
Junior from Hampstead, New York. Came in today with 21 tackles on the campaign, 4 pass breakups, and a fumble recovery.
Dan, I strongly suspect that the Falcons may get creative on this kickoff return. You know, we may see them try a throwback or something, try to break a big one here. But if they don't get that, and if they don't get into, say, Owl territory, we're going to see Joe Haskins take a knee and then go to the locker room.
39 seconds, no timeouts. Even though the Owls get the ball to start the second half, it's kind of challenging to work with that. Christian Julian to kick off, sophomore from Hingham. And that's a kick that will bounce up and stay in play. Palazzo will step up to receive it. Gets a decent run back past the 30-yard line.
Pretty good return for Palazzo, but still it would be 70 yards to go for the Falcon offense in 30 seconds with no timeouts. And that's of course assuming that they go the entire way without being penalized, which is not necessarily true. We do have Logan Wilson coming in at quarterback for the Falcons. Maybe they're going to try a couple balls downfield. I mean, you're 0-9 trailing by 3 scores to another 0-9 team. Why not?
It's like, what do you have to lose at this juncture?
And they're on 31.
So they do bring in Wilson.
Ben Wilson has a bit of a stronger arm. He'll roll on first down, use Stanford as a blocker. Throw hard. And that one is nearly hauled in by Matt Kimball.
Nearly hauled in by Kimball, and to be quite honest, Kimball was nearly decapitated by Joseph Dumoulin. And Dan, the most incredible thing has happened. A gentleman has thrown a yellow handkerchief onto the field. Dan, the most incredible thing has just happened again. 2 flags on the play. That was a very hard hit to the head. I would not be surprised if the officials ask Mr. Dumoulin to see himself away from the football field. I think we could be seeing a targeting penalty here. We've got basically the entire officiating crew converging at about the Westfield 40-yard line.
There was also concerns about possibly words being exchanged after the play, because the flag came in, you know, after the ball had come onto the ground, and then the second flag came a bit after that. And I saw another official ready to throw a third one until he decided, no, the other two were sufficient.
So right there, the pass is gone, and then just lowering his head is Dumoulin delivering a big shot to Kimball. Kimball did get up and walk away under his own power, so that's good. But it looked like a pretty vicious hit live. Seeing the replay there doesn't really change my opinion on it.
Now they'll talk with Pete Kowalski, the head coach of the Owls. 8th year as head coach, he's been with the program since the mid-90s.
Now they're going to head over to the Fitchburg sideline, talk it over with Scott Sperone as well. Possible it could be offsetting fouls or let's get the call.
There were 2 flags on the play. The first flag is going to be wiped off. There's no targeting call on the play. After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct on the defense, number 33. 15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
So they talked about it, they decided it wasn't targeting, but they will still charge the unsportsmanlike conduct against William Soto.
Soto, the senior linebacker from Marlboro, Massachusetts, but you know, he went to Assabet Valley, what do you expect? Guilty of a 15-yard penalty there, so the Falcon offense gets another shot at it.
So Wilson again, quick drop back throws, that's going to be caught. And just getting out of bounds there is Palazze.
Falcon offense has got to move quickly. They have no timeouts here. Westfield State is content to play very loose coverage on defense.
Yep.
Clock's running, Logan. What are you doing here?
The clock had been stopped for a little while.
It's running now. The Falcons are in a huddle.
I didn't see the far side. The far side referee was not spinning his arm saying that that stayed in bounds. I think there's some miscommunication here.
So they stopped the clock to move the chains.
I think now the referee's been made aware that the clock's run.
The officials started blowing their whistles before the clock hit zeros. So even if everything was totally fine up until that point, I think they should put 3 or 4 seconds on the clock because that's when they started blowing their whistles.
There should absolutely be time back on the clock, is my opinion.
The question is just how much. I didn't see anything wrong with the way the clock started running after the play. It just seemed like the Falcons were taking a long time for, frankly, no good reason.
The previous play was ruled inbounds. The clock was stopped for the first down signal and then rewound after we reset the ball. We stopped the clock for the discussion. We'll reset the game clock to 10 seconds. The clock will start on the wind.
So they'll put 10 seconds on the clock. They said they did rule the play ended inbounds.
Which it did.
I imagine it was just a matter of getting, I think there were some signals crossed there. Now Fitchburg will quickly snap it. Wilson with a bit of time, but having trouble keeping traction. He's gonna make a beeline to the sideline. He gets out of bounds, but the clock has stopped unless the most incredible thing has happened again.
I see nothing incredible here. The clock is at zeros. So, it's Falcon offense is still on the field. Are they seriously gonna argue for, they put 1 second back on the clock, Dan.
They say he got out of bounds in time.
Okay. So Fitchburg State is still alive here. It's a good game by Wilson. I thought there was way too much time there, but it's a first down. He got out of bounds. There's 1 second out on the clock. Actually, I guess it's 2nd and 9.
They're gonna try the field goal.
They're running out of, what would this be, about a 44-yard field goal? 43
yards from Matt Kimball, right to left. He's got some leg and he got blocked. Kimball will just try to get on top of that one. Now Westfield's gonna try to scoop and score it is what they're gonna try to do. And that's a horse collar to pull him down. If the most incredible thing has happened again, then Westfield would get a free play. But no, I thought it was a horse collar, but no.
It certainly looked like it. At the end of the play there, I thought Stanford grabbed the returner. I think that was I think it was Adam Laguerre who wound up with the football for Westfield. And then he was horse collared down by Stanford, but a remarkable final 30 seconds or so of the first half, Dan. This game has gotten ugly in a lot of different ways in the past, you know, say 2-3 minutes of football.
I guess it's like, I said we'd be in for an exciting game, an interesting game. Fitchburg's not getting the results that they would like, but.
Part of the reason that it got very ugly in the last 3 minutes of football is that the last 3 minutes of football took, what, 45 minutes?
Took too long. We had too many examples of the most incredible thing happening. We had the clock discombobulation as well. And
Let's break that down really quickly. I think Fitchburg State just completely bungled it. They got a first down, play was ruled dead inbounds with, say, 18 seconds left on the clock. They stopped the clock, they moved the chains, they reset the chains, they wind the clock. When they wound the clock, the Fitchburg Falcons were huddled up. Their quarterback, Logan Wilson, was talking to his head coach as if there was 10 minutes and 16 seconds in the half. Fitchburg State was not hurrying up at all. But everyone else, including fans on the near sidelines and the officials, were looking at their watches, looking at the scoreboard, and saying, hey, Logan, there's like 12 seconds left on the clock. Are you going to run a play here, buddy?
My thing is...
And then they blew the whistles.
When I watched the play happen, when I saw the ball go out to the sideline, what I saw was the official running on, waving his hands to signal a completed catch. Normally, if it's one of those things that's close, where the ball is inbounds, he'll usually be winding his arm around. Mm-hmm. I did not see the official wind his arm around.
Okay.
And that may have... And when you make the signal where you're crossing your arms over your head like that, without the winding signal, that implies that the play stopped out of bounds.
Okay.
And I think that's what Fitchburg saw. Now, I could have missed the signal after I looked away,
right,
but I think that's what Fitchburg saw. So they made the impression from there the clock was going to start on the snap, which is why they took their time. And then when the clock wound, obviously they were caught off guard by that.
Okay.
If that is indeed what happened, I'm not against the idea of giving them that extra time because
right,
clearly something got crossed up there.
Right. Okay.
So that's my interpretation of it.
And then you have the other play, the play after that. You know, Wilson scrambles around, runs out of bounds, ducks out with 1 second on the clock, which good job by him, good awareness of the time. And then they line up for the very long field goal, which gets blocked, and that turns into a whole thing. It was a very exciting end of the half. It came to nothing in terms of points for the Falcons. Teams are heading to the locker rooms. We will take the halftime break as well. 19-0 Westfield is the score here from Elliott Field. But come on back for the second half of action. It's College Football Saturday here on FATV. 19-0 Westfield State leads Fitchburg State here from Elliott Field on the campus of Fitchburg State University, just off of John Fitch Highway in beautiful Fitchburg, Massachusetts. Here on FATV, John Cooperty, joined as always by Dan Golag. Dan, why don't we take a look at some of the halftime statistics as the Owls have a 3-score lead in the battle to avoid the wooden spoon.
So as we mentioned, 19-0 Westfield in front at halftime, 13 first downs for the Owls. They've gone 28 rushes for 163 yards and 7 for 13 through the air for 66 yards. It's Gabriel Fernandez. He has 2 touchdowns. That's 229 total yards of offense for the Owls, while Fitchburg State held to just 78 yards of offense in the first half. Joe Haskins, 1-7 for 9 yards. Logan Wilson with a completion for 18. And Justin Stanford, the leading runner for the Falcons, 8 for 35 on the ground, but a fumble lost. Haskins, a 16-yard run on the first play from scrimmage, but not much more since then. For the Owls, Gabe Fernandez, 5 for 44 on the ground. Shane Clark, 9 for 61. Lee Colon, 14 for 58. Fernandez also has a touchdown run, 1-yard sneak. And then for the receivers, Ben Palazze, 1 for 18. And Torian Wise Jr. coming up with a 9-yard catch on a fake. While for the Owls, Danny Farrell's got a touchdown, 2 for 29 through the air. Jamar Johnson has a 7-yard touchdown catch. Lee Colon, 2 for 12. And Cordell Parrish and Anthony Centrone have catches as well. Also of note, Torian Wise Jr., I know we saw him come up, you know, with an injury a little bit, but was able to get off the field. He was everywhere in the first half, 8 tackles, 7 by himself as well. He is a man possessed out there for the Falcons.
Making it happen on both sides of the football is Torian Wise Jr. as the Falcons take the field and we get ready for the second half of action here. Dan, we expected a pretty close game here, a couple of 0-9 teams, but as we said, Westfield State, you know, they haven't been able to find victory in their last 3 or 4 games, but they've certainly been improving their performances. You know, double-digit scores a few times out. Last time they put 30 on Worcester State and were only defeated by a last-second Hail Mary, and today they look like a much better football team than Fitchburg State. And also, with their freshman quarterback, Gabriel Fernandez, you know, obviously for the Owls, they are 0-9, but they have, you know, a few really positive signs right now that Fitchburg State is, frankly, still looking for.
Fernandez has just played tremendously well, tremendously poised, as just a freshman. But he's been doing very well, comfortable running the ball, comfortable throwing the ball. He's found a lot of open receivers downfield. That's been a positive for the Owls. Also of note, both teams want to clean up in the second half are the penalties.
Really, Dan, have penalties been a factor in this football game? I don't think there's been a penalty. I don't think we've seen one. No?
Let's see how many. We have 146 penalty yards in this game.
Oh, is that all?
Yep, on 14 penalties. Mm-hmm. And then we had three penalties that were waved off.
It's notable when you see one, and we have seen three. So if you hear us say these words in this order, Dan, the most remarkable thing has happened. A gentleman has thrown a yellow handkerchief onto the playing surface. Well, it became a running joke in the middle of the second quarter. So, yeah, that's where we are in terms of this game.
And then I'm not counting the penalties that were declined either.
That has also been a factor. There have been a few of those.
So, wonderful stuff on there.
As the Falcons get ready to kick off for the second half, we will see Linnea DeKeel do the kicking for the Falcons, one of the many seniors being honored here. I believe this will be her first ever kickoff as a Falcon.
Indeed. I'm curious to see what she can do with it.
Linnea DeKeel to kick it away for the Falcons.
And also what the Falcons want to do with it.
I wonder if Linnea's got a surprise onside in her game. Just a thought.
She'll put it on the ground, popping up and around in the air. That could be pulled in by the Falcons. It's not.
Was very close, though. Westfield State had a number of guys up toward the line there. They thought something might be up. You know, a team down by three scores doesn't like giving the other side the ball, so Falcons made him work for it. It was a pretty good kick, all in all, by Linnea. You know, you expect with an onside kick, especially at this level, the thing is just make sure it goes 10 yards and make it bounce a little. And then you just kind of see what happens. This time it bounced toward the Owls.
Owen Thompson ultimately was the one who gathered it in for Westfield State on first down. Shane Clark to the left side. Gets about 4 yards forward and 5 yards back, but the forward ones are the ones that will count.
That's right. Clark had a big 46-yard run in the first half. Other than that, he really hasn't had much. You know, outside of that one gain, it's been 8 carries for 15 yards. But he put up a pretty good gain there. Call it second down and 6 now for the Owls, as they're already almost out to midfield after recovering the onside kick.
51 yards from goal. Just one in the backfield, and the end-around pitch to Cintron makes his way to the far side, and that's where Westfield's found a lot of their success in the first half, is getting out to the flanks, to the sidelines. And he's able to get just enough for the first down. Mark him down at the Fitchburg 45.
Those outside runs have been very successful for Westfield State. You see here, Cintron looked like he wanted to cut upfield then, but decided to go further out toward the edge. He was able to turn the corner, go upfield, pick up the first down. So it's first and 10 Owls at the Falcon 45.
And now, faking the handoff, throw out to the left side. The most incredible thing has happened again, as spinning and making his way down the field was Connor Schittler.
Try that one again, Dan.
Schittler.
Thank you. But it will come to naught. It is a block in the back against the Owls.
That's one of those announcer's nightmare names.
Eh, well.
And it seems like every time he does things, that the most amazing thing happens.
This is true.
He's been guilty of a couple of them today. This time he does a thing.
This time Danny Farrell is guilty of a block in the back. It's one of those calls that I see in pretty much every big run in Madden until I turn the sliders down.
Clark will try to burst up the middle this time, get a few of them back.
It could just be that Robbie Anderson is a particularly penalty-prone receiver because it's always on him, but no, I just turn the sliders down. I'm one of those players that if I have a really bad game, I will just reset and play it again. So.
Are you a franchise mode guy?
Yeah, did a fantasy draft because honestly, I don't know who's who in the NFL anymore. So. Got Kyler Murray and Travis Henry. It's a good thing.
What team do you play as?
Patriots.
Of course.
Of course.
So second down, much to go. Quick pass out to Cintron. That's going to be caught. Ashima trying to wrap him up. He has done enough to wrap him up. And the most incredible thing has happened again because he just body slammed him to the turf.
Okay. I feel the need to point out, when you grab the man from the waist from behind and you lift him up and you drop him on his head like that, that's a German suplex. A body slam is when you grab him from the front, you scoop him up, and then you throw him down. So he was going for the German suplex. It turned into almost a wrestling throw.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness on the defense, number 25. 15 yards from the end of the run.
So this comes well after the play. You know, Ashima does a good job, grab the man, and right there, they've already blown the whistle. By the time Ashima herks him up and starts bringing him down, they've already blown the whistle, and the whistles had been going for quite a while before that play.
Did seem like forward progress was called quite quickly on that one.
It was a bit of a quick whistle, but it was also very clear whistles. Mm-hmm. And now we've got more pushing, more shoving. There's a Falcon down. I think he just got pushed to the turf. You've got one Owl pulling another one away. Gabriel Fernandez, the quarterback, had to grab Gilberto Rodriguez, one of his offensive linemen, and just grab him, pull him away from the play.
And that's a tough feat because, you know, Rodriguez is 6 feet tall, 370.
Yeah, you know, Rodriguez, big number 57 there, but, you know, Fernandez is the quarterback. You got to listen to him when he tells you to stop shoving the other guy, but this game is, what's the word we like to use? Ah, yes, chippy. I think we can officially say that it has gotten chippy.
I mean, I don't even see a yellow handkerchief on the field, but they're all acting like they're going to make a call based on it being on the field somewhere.
Yeah, so you've got pushing and shoving after the play off to the right. Then on the left side of the screen as well, you've got Rodriguez and Lucero going at it. There's a couple different instances there.
I understand these two teams have been frustrated with how the season's gone. The last 10 weeks, they've played 9 games. They've lost them all. At this point, they've actually brought Pete Kowalski and Scott Sperone to midfield.
I don't know how much leeway the officials really have, but at some point, they've got to take these coaches and say, look, guys, tell your guys we are going to play football here, and if we're going to play shove each other around and hurt each other, we're not even going to play football. We will just throw this game out. Because, you know, for all the importance we make of it being an 0-9
versus an 0-9.
Yeah, an 0-9 team versus an 0-9 team. And I think this is what the coaches are doing. They're gathering all of their rosters together and saying, look, this has got to end. There's been enough pushing. There's been enough shoving. There have been enough of these personal fouls. There's been enough jawing. You just saw Coach Sperone right there making that little stop talking at each other motion. This is, I think the officiating crew is laying down the hammer here and saying, enough is enough, guys. If we want to play football here, we can play football. But if we're going to keep shoving, if we're going to keep trying to hurt each other, we will just go home. And quite frankly, I can't say it's a bad call. Mm-hmm. This game has gotten almost out of hand a number of times. It's two 0-9 teams, one of which is clearly better than the other. There's nothing on the line here. If you're going to play dirty, then you shouldn't play. And if these teams are going to play dirty, then we should pack up and go home.
Probably also additional warnings that any more of these shenanigans and we'll just start throwing people out of the game. We'll tell people to get on the dang bus. Clark with the run up the middle. And you can see the Falcons now, it's like on the whistle, putting their hands up. We're not touching them anymore.
We're done.
We've got the message.
They understand the assignment.
Gain of a couple for Clark up the middle. Owls would be particularly interested in letting the clock run a bit. Protecting a 19-point lead.
And you see there, as you pointed out, Dan, as soon as the whistles go, each of the Falcons is like, okay, I get it. So, At least for the moment, they want to keep playing.
Hernandez lost the football as he was tackled from behind. The big man, Gilberto Rodriguez, gets on top of it to bring an end to the play.
Hernandez never saw the pressure coming until the last moment, and by the time he did, Cam Monette was right on top of him. Sacks the quarterback, knocks the ball loose. Rodriguez falls on it, but it's a huge loss. It's a stop for the Falcon defense, and the Owls will punt.
Clark will come back out to punt it away. We've seen him punt it once today, and he was able to nearly pin the Falcons at their one. That is a low snap, bounces on the ground. Now he's gonna run with it himself. Is he gonna be able to get the yards he needs for the first down? He's gonna get pretty close to it.
I think he's got it, Dan.
We've mentioned the threat of having your quarterback be the punter. This is the threat of having a running back be your punter.
I wonder, was this the design? Is this something that they let Clark have the option? Like, if you see it, you can go for it? Or
was this a case of, you know, the ball was on the ground, there's perhaps a bit of pressure sensed, he just decides, I'll just go for it.
Well, as it is, needed 22. Coach Sperone is not happy at the moment. Hard to argue with him. Mostly because he's angry and loud, and I don't like confrontation.
Cologne with the run on first down up the middle, a minuscule amount of yardage gained. So, 10 minutes to go, third quarter, 19-0 in favor of Westfield State. If you're looking for the Fitchburg-Algonquin game, we'll have that on delay in the days to come.
Kevin Newey over at Crocker Field recording that as we speak.
Cologne bounces off a tackle, spins forward. Lee Cologne. Winningham and Perez teaming up for the tackle there. Perez the first to arrive.
And I suppose we should mention, of course, we will have Thanksgiving football, Fitchburg versus Leominster from historic Crocker Field.
140th meeting between the two teams, 115th on Thanksgiving. That'll be on Thanksgiving. 10 a.m. kickoff. We'll start a little earlier than that, of course.
First time since 2019, Thanksgiving football. You'll love to see it.
Hernandez with time. He's got space to run on the left side, making his way to the sideline. Inside the 10-yard line, he goes for another first down.
Mentioned earlier, Fernandez is not a super speedy quarterback in the mold of like a Jeremy Kimber from back in the day for the Falcons, but he's got the athleticism, you know. If you want to compare him to another Falcon quarterback, it evokes memories of Garrett Delakeye, Daniel. He's got the arm, he's got the pocket presence, but he also has enough mobility that when it breaks down, he can make something happen.
If he could be as good as Garrett Delakeye, that could make Westfield a tremendous team in the years to come. As Clark driving his way towards the goal line, he gets in there, touchdown.
Dan, are we sure Westfield State's 0-9? That doesn't seem right.
They are not playing like the team that you'd expect to be 0-9 in this contest. As I've said, they've definitely been catching fire as the season has gone on. Extra point, well, that was awful too.
Okay, when they're attempting extra points, they look like an 0-9 team.
Yes.
We can say that.
Farrell has missed 2 from 6 attempts coming into today, and the 2 that he's missed, he's not even gotten close to the elevation he needed.
See there, it's just fantastic blocking by the Owl offensive line, and then Clark does a good job finding the hole, following the blockers, makes that extra move right at the goal line, and he gets in to extend the Westfield lead to 25-0, which is where it stands right now.
And while we have a moment, we want to remind you that FATV Remote Productions, underwritten by Workers Credit Union, Rollstone Bank and Trust, UMass Memorial Health, Health Alliance, Clinton Hospital, North End Subaru, Unitil, Minuteman Press, and the Sentinel and Enterprise. We thank them for all the support they give us to make all these remote productions possible.
And we also want to thank our crew. Our director today is Nate Glennie. Travis Falk handling the audio and graphics for us. Todd Govin doing a fantastic job on replay, as always. And our camera crew, Robin Como and Jared Roberts up top. Moritz Vetter handled the first half down on the field. Kayla Jorgensen has taken over, both of them doing fantastic work as well. Thank you to all of them for the work that they do for FATV.
Christian Julian to kick off. Boots it with the left leg. Balled in by Palazzo from the 20. Makes his way to the far side and hauled down at the 35-yard line. Another solid return for the former Grove City football player.
First and 10 from their own 35.
Falcon offense will come back out on the field. We saw Logan Wilson at quarterback for the last drive of the first half, but that was just to get the ball aired out downfield. Joe Haskins is back in as the quarterback right now.
The Falcons have noted that Wilson is the better quarterback when it comes to throwing the football, but Haskins a little more mobile.
Let's go home!
Gives them a few more options in the playbook. First down is Justin Stanford. Trying to find some space on the right side. The Owls
Justin
closing
Stanford
the gaps quickly.
Short game.
And only 1 yard gained by Stanford.
Stanford had 20 plus carries, looked like a really impressive force out of the backfield in last week's loss. Unfortunately for him, not as successful overall today. 8 carries, 35 yards in the first half, which is a pretty good average, but that's buoyed by a 12 yard gain, which is his long. Other than that, he really hasn't done much.
Stanford.
This time, you know, with Fitchburg coming out as if that's what they wanted to plan with, having Stanford as their lead running back for the week. The Owls have been game planning around that, it so appears. A 3 yard gain for Stanford on second down.
Take a look at it again. It's just it's a simple, you know, handoff straight up the middle out of that flex bone formation, which has been the Falcons' bread and butter all season.
As we've mentioned too, the Falcons' O-line has been challenged by injuries throughout the season, which has made things a little more difficult for them. Quick throw, it's gonna be caught by Mangrum. Will be good enough for the first down as he ends up at the 48-yard line.
That is a very well-designed play, Dan. You've got Mack Kimble comes in motion. He runs a quick flat route from the slot, but then Mangrum running the in from the wide position. It confuses the defenders. It mixes them up. You see there, Westfield State had no real coverage on Mangrum. That's because everybody took a step back to cover Kimble. Mangrum was wide open. Haskins delivered the ball and got the first down.
Fitchburg, not too many first downs today on third down. In fact, that would be their first from my count. As Stanford is trying to find some space to run with, he does actually get out to the flank. He's staying on his feet.
Hard running for Justin Stanford.
He gets a couple of yards where it looked like he probably could have been held
Nate
for a
Nelson
loss.
Had the Westfield hit.
Okay, if you draw it up and you say, all right, Justin Stanford is going to take the ball and bounce it to the outside, someone is going to stop you and say, hold on, what are you doing? But this actually worked.
Midfield.
Tries to go up the middle, nothing there. Tries to bounce it to the outside, makes a man miss. You know, it's only a 2 or 3 yard gain, but it's a pretty impressive run.
Brings up a 2nd and 8.
Let's go!
Falcons down 25-0. And some good misdirection there, and blowing through the middle is Matty Aguirre. And he gets about 10 on that one, puts the ball down on the Owls 40.
Falcon offense, first and 10 from the West.
Falcons will hurry back up to the line. That time they tried they faked the pitch to Kimble. And Aguirre just took the handoff, went straight up the middle. Everybody on the Owls defense bit on the pitch. Left a big hole for Aguirre.
5.5 to go in the frame. Stanford churning upfield. Gets about 5 before he's forced back.
Stanford.
And that's where a guy like Stanford really comes in handy out of the backfield. Dan, Fitchburg State gets the first down. They run the hurry up. They've got Westfield on the back foot.
2nd and 6.
And then you hand it to the big man. You know, Westfield's defense maybe not able to get as set as they'd like. And they've got that big boulder to deal with.
Lots of things happen there.
Dan, the most remarkable thing has happened. Gentleman has thrown a yellow handkerchief onto the playing surface. think this is going to be a false start. But then again, the Falcons players are applauding, so maybe not.
Lots of movement on the line there. Who moved first?
Right to the motion by the offense. Offsides. On the defense, number 99. 5-yard penalty. Repeat the down.
Know what you are guilty of the infraction, so we'll take a look at it again. Westfield State is trying to... They're trying to time the snap count, so they're bringing the blitz. They're jumping. And that motion right there is what causes the Falcon player lined up on the left end to jump early. From that replay, I don't think any Owls had crossed the line when the Falcon jumped, but the officials disagreed.
Quick throw to Kimball is complete. Pushed out of bounds at the 24-yard line. That'll get another first down.
Falcons have found a little more success through the air on this drive. It's nothing super fancy, nothing downfield, but you just get your receivers a little bit of space out in the flat, and Haskins is able to deliver the ball.
Now here's Aguirre again. Just the way that they move the ball around on that particular handoff, there's a lot of misdirection on that.
Yeah, a lot of moving pieces, a lot of things the Falcons can do with that man in motion. We saw them try it earlier in the drive. They do it again here, make it look like it's going to be a pitch to Kimball, but it's actually the trap to Aguirre. He's got a decent little gain out of it.
Now a pitch out left side. It gives way around.
Matt Kimball.
It's going to be Kimball with the run. Gets inside the 20-yard line.
And you know, Dan, from this spot right here, you're lined up on the left hash mark. I wouldn't be shocked if the Falcons go back to the first play they called from scrimmage. The same formation, send Kimball in motion, pitch it to him, and then see if he can throw it. They tried to do that on the first play from scrimmage, and it got blown up. But here on this drive, they've done the pitch a couple of times. It's gotten good yardage. Let's see. Don't see Kimball on the field right now.
He's there as the right slot back. But they've gone to Stanford to try to bowl over those yards. He's going to get to the 15.
Stanford.
Not quite enough for a first.
Got to think it's four down territory, though, for the Falcons.
We saw them try a field goal earlier in the contest, but that was a little different at the time.
That was a 40-something yard attempt that they tried because they were up against the clock and had no alternative that they liked. But now it's fourth and two. They keep the offense on the field.
The Haskins went for the sneak. He scored Haskins. A couple touchdowns on sneaks. Trying to get a first down here on fourth. I think it'll be near enough that it's going to come down to the spot and perhaps a measurement.
Surprise quarterback sneak on fourth and two. Dan, have we seen a measurement at Elliott Field all season?
Maybe once or so.
I don't remember.
It looked like a short two. Because I didn't think the stick was quite at the 13-yard line. And as you can see, the ball is...
I think he's short. I'm going to say he's a little bit short. It's tough to tell from there, but...
You got it.
That is a first down. Okay. That's what I get for making predictions.
Yeah, I thought the ball was not quite at the... I thought the sticks were not quite at the 13. It looked more like fourth and one and a half as opposed to two. And it looks like Haskins got 2 yards.
From the Westfield 14.
That would be near enough. And they're this close to finding pay dirt.
A really good plunge there by Joe Haskins. Just got enough of a push from his center, his right guard. He was able to get the first down.
Closing it on two to go, third quarter. Throw right side to the end zone. Touchdown, Falcons! Tim O'Neill pulls it in to get the green and gold on the board.
For
from the hand of Joseph.
Dan, we mentioned in the first half, Westfield State scored a touchdown, running a fade with a physical mismatch of a taller receiver against a much shorter defensive back. This time, it's the reverse. You've got Tim O'Neill listed at 5'8", going up against 6' even Matt Hadley. But Haskins delivered the ball perfectly to where only O'Neill could make the catch. Make the catch he did, and Fitchburg State is on the board.
It'll be Kimball to try the extra point here. Snap down, kick up. It's good. 2:03 to go in the third quarter. The Falcons are on the board. It's 25-7.
Don't count Fitchburg State out just yet. Get ready to count Fitchburg State out, but don't count Fitchburg State out just yet.
It's like trying to count out touchdown Tom.
I wouldn't go that far, but you know, it's not a thing you should do. We want to remind folks at home that FATV is your local access TV station. If you live, work, in, go to school, or are a member of a Fitchburg organization, you too can become a member of FATV, like me and Dan. Membership brings many benefits and gives you access to all of FATV's equipment, including cameras, audio and lighting equipment, edit suites, studios, and so much more, including the newest addition, the FATV Podcast Suite. We offer technical training classes to teach you how to create your own program. You can also reserve channel time to broadcast your program to the community and beyond. Visit FATV.org for more details and start producing your own show today.
So we'll look and see how the Falcons deal with this kickoff. They've got Kimball back into the contest.
Kimball to kick it away for the Falcons.
Try to kick it away. The Falcons have succeeded on onside kicks a few times this season.
Westfield State is suspecting some trickery here.
Especially since if they're going to wind up there, go for the pooch. And it'll be hauled in a fair catch there by Farrell.
Well, when you've got that many guys lined up that close to the line, the, you know, quote-unquote traditional surprise onside kick where you just run up and try to kick it short isn't going to work. So that time they try to catch Westfield State off guard, kick it over their heads, and then see what can happen there. But no, Owls were well prepared. Fitchburg State's tried that enough times this season that I think everybody who has them coming up is aware. Look, if they're kicking off, they're not kicking it deep. They're trying something weird.
Only a few times have they actually had the chance to kick it deep. Kimball's got the ability to do it. He's done it. It's just a matter of the circumstances have just not allowed it. First down, Justin Jean Charles with the run.
Justin John Charles, the ball carrier.
To the 42-yard line, as we said.
Four.
He was briefly a Falcon. I remember him as a kick returner back when he was a freshman.
Senior from Springfield. Hasn't seen much action for Westfield State, but might see a bit more here.
Fernandez with a very good run here. Just trucked over a man.
Gabriel Fernandez with a nice run.
How often do you see the quarterback delivering the truck, just lowering his shoulder and running through Joel Montero there? But that time, Gabriel Fernandez did just that. It was a big hit that he leveled.
Owls first and 10 from the Fitchburg 38.
Just tremendous play there by the Westfield quarterback in the freshman Gabriel Fernandez. 6'1", 197. Gene Charles with some moves up to the left side.
John Charles, the ball carrier.
Makes his way to the 34.
Jordan Cummings.
J.J. Cummings with the tackle for the Falcons.
Gain of 5 on the play.
We tick under a minute to go in the third quarter. And Westfield's offense continuing to operate like a well-oiled machine. Another handoff for Gene Charles and a lot more space on the left side. There's way too much space on the left side. And inside the 10 goes Gene Charles.
Big game for Gene.
Gotta feel good for him. Like you said, Dan, the former Falcon returning to Elliott Field for the final game of his senior season. Didn't play much of a role in the first half, but he's getting some rollout here in the third quarter and he's making the most of it.
12 carries for 29 yards coming into today. Also had fumbled the ball four times. Tries to bounce out to the left side. Three Falcons will swarm him.
John Charles, the ball carrier.
Take him down as we reach three-quarter time at Elliott Field.
Luke Noyes and Jordan Cummings combined.
Westfield State holding an 18-point lead, but looking for more.
Here at Fitchburg State.
One thing to mention, Dan, as Westfield marches downfield, the Falcon defense right now is without the services of Dakota Lucero, the junior linebacker. He has been a big part of this Fitchburg State defense, and he is not on the field right now. He has been tended to on the near sideline for the past several plays. He's been, you know, clutching at his chest. You've been seeing coaches attend to him. So Dakota Lucero not on the field for Fitchburg State. We'll keep an eye on him, see if he gets back into this game. We certainly hope that he is all right. But as the teams take the long walk down, this is weird, Dan. We've seen twice today at the end of each quarter. It's been inside the five-yard line. And actually, you see there once again Dakota Lucero taking the jersey off so that he can be tended to. So definitely something in need of attention there for Dakota Lucero. We hope everything's all right with him. But it is weird, Dan, both times at the end of the first and now the end of the third quarter, teams have had to go all the way down the other side of the field because Westfield State has been inside the Fitchburg 10.
It's been impressive how good Westfield has looked last game of the year. You know, they've probably been circling the state. I mean, they've been hoping for, you know, a win earlier. They've been come so close in games throughout the season. But today, everything is going the way they want it to.
Westfield second and goal.
Now second and goal for the Owls, right on the doorstep.
Handoff goes to Gene Charles, plunging straight up the middle. It's across the five, but really no further than that. Justin Gene Charles brought down. It'll be third down and goal. Gene Charles looking for his first touchdown of his senior season.
At the Fitchburg State hit, third and goal.
Give Cam Manette credit for the tackle there.
336 yards for the Owls on the ground today. Well, overall, I should say. But most of it is coming on the ground.
Now Gene Charles gets the pitch near side on third down. Dives for the pylon. He is in.
Touchdown
Owls. Justin Gene Charles from 5 yards out. As we said, the former Falcon scoring at Elliott Field, but for Westfield State.
Felt like it was one of those things that Westfield wanted to check off their bucket list if they had a chance, was to try to get Gene Charles a touchdown.
And I'm sure he's appreciative.
Defense, 25.
Dan, the most remarkable thing happened while we weren't looking. There was a penalty charge against the Falcons that will be declined. So Westfield State will take the points instead, and they will keep their offense on the field.
Yeah, I think we've established the extra point game is not working reliably enough to keep rolling it.
No, not really. So they will go for two, try to make it a 26-point game. Send a man in motion, but they pitch it to Gene Charles. Pretty much the same play as the touchdown. Tries to cut back. This time there's nothing doing. 2-point conversion attempt is no good. Westfield State leading 31-7, still technically a 3-score game. Although each of those touchdowns would need to be followed by 2-point conversions. So, you remember 2-3 minutes of football ago when I was saying don't count Fitchburg State out? You can count Fitchburg State, you know, OU. How about that?
Is it time to count the Falcons out? Well, we'll find out in a few minutes. Let's have an out-of-town scoreboard.
That sounds like a plan. Tell me some scores from out-of-town.
All right. At three-quarter time at Coughlin Field in Worcester, it is Worcester State 7, Framingham State 33. At Cressy Field in Dartmouth, it is UMass Dartmouth 20, Plymouth State 0. And at Clean Harbor Stadium in Buzzards Bay, it's Mass Maritime 7, Bridgewater State 28.
So all of the Cranberries will be going back to Bridgewater, is what you said.
As it appears, unless the Buccaneers can pull some magic off in the fourth quarter. Also, just to have a moment, how the rest of the Falcons are doing. Women's basketball taking on Anna Maria at Curry's tournament out in Milton. 51-31 with 2 minutes to go in the third quarter. Fitchburg State men's basketball is at Keene State. Live stats require an extra window because they're sidearm sight. And that was an onside kick.
That was a kick that hit an up man, picked up by Gabe Mangrum. Cuts it to the near sideline, gets close to midfield. That was not an intentional onside kick. I think it just struck one of the upbacks for the Falcons. Picked up on the fly by Mangrum. He got some yardage out of it. This could have been disastrous for Fitchburg.
Yeah, that was interesting. I bet I was not paying 100% attention because doing scoreboards, but still. Yeah, just on the ground, picks off the up man, but Fitchburg at least able to haul it in, and they have great field position. They'll take advantage of what could very well have been a Westfield error.
First and 10 Falcons at midfield. Joe Haskins under center. Justin Stanford is the tailback. Play fake. Haskins pitches on the option. Kimball's got it. He's across midfield to about the 49-yard line. Give Mac Kimball a yard.
I'm not doing that.
Westfield. Ball
okay, it was Matty Aguirre. Give Matty Aguirre a yard?
I'll give him a yard.
Okay, fine.
That's how much misdirection they use out there.
That's right. That's also what happens when you don't have the TV numbers. Let's blame everyone except the guy who got the call. Second down and 9 for Fitchburg State. Kimball, seriously, Kimball, I mean it this time. Now he's going to throw. Wants to go deep, double covered, but it is brought in. A fantastic catch downfield. Marvin Jean-Baptiste. That was fantastic work by him, dealing with double coverage, a pass that was a little bit underthrown, but he was able to use his size, get into position, and make the catch, and the Falcons will hurry up to the line.
Emery and Henry.
Emery and Henry, indeed. They live together in perfect harmony as they dive forward up the middle with Stanford, and he gets about 5 yards. That's how that song goes, right?
Emery.
And
with the Westfield hit.
No? Sing it with me?
Yeah.
No?
Second and 4.
I know where you're getting at, though.
Falcons will go from the E&H again. Fumbled snap this time. Haskins will just pick it up. Take a knee.
You don't see teams trying to run that twice. I at least like the idea of changing formations and trying different things besides the flex bone.
Yeah, mix it up. Why not? Trying to spread out the owl defense. Make them think you're maybe tossing it out wide and then give it to the big man up the middle. You know, put fewer obstacles in front of him. Get him rolling downhill, who knows? It'll be third down and 6 now for Fitchburg State. Stanford's got it, ducks out of one tackle, breaks another. He's across the 5, he is in! Touchdown, Falcons! Justin Stanford.
10-yard touchdown rush for Justin Stanford.
Do you think when he came to Fitchburg State, did he ever think he was going to score a touchdown on the ground like that?
I mean, you know, the freshman from Warrenton, Georgia, why not? You know, maybe this was always the plan. Was always the plan for the converted defensive lineman, Justin Stanford. Look at the moves. Look at the moves. Look at the juke. Hops to one side, gets across the end zone. He's in.
Oh,
Falcons
yeah.
Fake the extra point. They will go for 2. Pass to the near side is incomplete. I could not believe that they were lined up to kick it, but it was a fake. And unfortunately for the Falcons, the conversion attempt is no good.
As Dominic Medina is the holder, he's a quarterback by trade as well. And he tried to find Luke Noyes on the right side, but you know, just had to get that throw off quickly. That was an interesting drive.
To say the least.
So I guess to finish what I was going to say with the scoreboard before, you know, everything started happening. Like I said, Fitchburg State is up at Keene State, battle of Route 12 there. That game in progress.
What sport is that?
That is men's basketball.
Thank you.
And Right now, Keene State's up 17-11.
Okay, that's early.
Yeah, they're less than 8 minutes into that game. And then Fitchburg State Ice Hockey is going down to Loring Arena in Framingham, take on the Rams. 7:40 start from down there. Fitchburg State finally got their season underway two nights ago against Salem State, in which they lit up the Vikings for eight.
It's a good start. You'll take that.
8-0 victory for the green and gold to open the season. Reese Bergman with a hat trick. Brian McGrath, 38 save shutout. We'll be seeing the Falcons on FATV, I do believe, in a couple months' time.
Is it me or has Brian McGrath been the Falcons goalie for like 5 years?
Well, he came back after the COVID season. This is his fourth year of eligibility.
There you go. So now the Falcons still trail by 3 scores. It's an 18-point deficit. Westfield State has one guy more than 10 yards downfield, so they don't believe this is going to be a straight deep kickoff. We'll see. Fitchburg State is at least, you know, committing to the bit, suggesting that they might. And they don't. Kimball tries the kick it to yourself onside kick, and the Owls fall on it. It's an interesting, how deep in the playbook, how many onside kicks do the Falcons have?
They do have quite a few. They've done a few and they've succeeded on a few this season as well. I hadn't seen the kick it to yourself one, well, maybe once I've seen it.
Owls first and 10 from the Fitchburg 45.
First and 10, Owls at the Fitchburg 45-yard line.
Owen Thompson recovered that one. I think that's the second one he's pulled in today. You don't usually get a chance to pull in multiple onside kicks.
You do not. First down handoff straight up the middle. That's a big hole. Finally brought down after a gain of 6. Ball comes out, but it was after the whistles had already blown.
John Charles, ball carrier.
Justin John Charles manages to hang on to it until the whistles that time.
Gain of 6.
And there was personnel issues on that one. Logan Perez coming onto the field pretty late. And I think the hole was sort of in that general direction.
Andrew Winningham and A.O. Lou Saint combined for that pitch for a hit. Second and 4.
Second down and 4 now for the Falcons.
Different running back, and that didn't work out at all.
That did not indeed. That was Blake Simpson, the ball carrier, freshman from Bellingham, ran right into his offensive line and then stumbled backwards. Take a look at it again. It's fantastic penetration by the Falcon D line.
Third and 11.
Andrew Winningham will go and just claim the tackle.
Yeah, Winningham's going to get credit for it. But it was, I think it was DeMora who had broken through and busted that one up. Actually pushed an Owl guard back. Now on third and 11, Fernandez rolling to his right. He's going to take it himself. Dan, the most remarkable thing has happened. A gentleman has thrown a yellow handkerchief onto the playing surface.
Fernandez keeps, there's a flag down.
Fernandez takes the ball out of bounds at about the Falcon 40-yard line. But it's a hold against the Owls, so this one will come back.
Westfield, they'll bring them up to 120 penalty Holden yards today.
Offense, number 55.
Although it'll be their 11th accepted penalty.
15 third down.
It's not good.
No, it's not. Let's see, coming into today, how many penalty yards were these teams averaging? Fitchburg was averaging 60, and Westfield was averaging less than that, 57.78.
I would not be surprised if each team has more than that combined.
Yeah, no, they do. Fitchburg has 63 on the day, and that will bring Westfield to 120. So they've actually doubled it.
So it'll be third down and about 21 after the penalty. Simpson remains in the backfield, and he will get the carry, just a straight handoff up the middle. This time he's able to get back to the line of scrimmage before Winningham brings him down.
Fourth down, Owls.
There's an Owl down after the play as well. Very slow to get up. I believe that's Gabriel Velez. We've seen a lot of him today. The junior from New London, Connecticut. The again, folks, if you're looking for Fitchburg High School football as they take on Algonquin, that game is happening at Crocker Field, but we are recording it and we will have it on FATV and FATV.org in the days to come. That, of course, a non-playoff matchup. Fitchburg State, Fitchburg High, rather, unfortunately knocked out of the playoffs by Westfield High a couple weeks back.
And Westfield High actually knocked off Plymouth South last night. So Westfield is into the Final Four in Division III.
They're a good team.
Yeah, 21-7, whatever I wrote on there. 21-6 is what I wrote on there. That was the score line.
Set deep for the Falcons.
Great defense by the Bombers. 54 points conceded. 52 points conceded. That's how many it is.
Fourth down. Owls will kick it away. This is a high, short punt. It's going to bounce at the 23. I'm surprised the Falcons didn't go for the onside kick. But it's kicked by an Owl at about the 23-yard line, and I think that's where the Falcons will get it. So Fitchburg State's defense gets a stop. Offense will come back out on the field with, you know, a mathematical chance, if nothing else. Trailing 31-13 with just over 10 minutes to play here.
It's going to take three possessions. It's going to take emptying the playbook, probably.
But hey, stranger things have happened, right?
I feel like the Falcons do the best when the formations they throw out there are the most entertaining.
That's true. Fairly conventional flex bone here on first down for Fitchburg State. They do have Stanford in the backfield. Motion, Kimball keeps it himself, fakes the pitch, wants to reverse field, decides not to. And he's brought down after about three. I think I said Kimball kept it himself. It was Haskins who kept it himself.
Except for that one throw Kimball did have in the contest. We haven't seen him playing the role of quarterback, essentially. Although, as we've talked about before throughout the season, he did play some quarterback at Becker College.
All in all, it's no gain for Haskins. He got back to the line of scrimmage, but no further than that. It'll be second down and call it 10. Kimball in motion. This time he takes the pitch. Straight run this time. No looking downfield. He is shoulder blocked down. Ran right into the right shoulder of William Soto. Looked a bit like maybe a full gear preview. Brian Danielson bouncing off of Miro. I bet we see that happen later tonight.
Just a big thunk. There goes the momentum.
But it is a gain of 5 for Kimball. Now they fake the pitch handed to Aire, trying to run the trap to the left side. And unfortunately for him, he's tripped up pretty much right at the line of scrimmage. No gain there. It'll be 4th and 5. But, you know, less than 10 minutes to play. Final game of the season. Down by 3. Well, I thought the offense was staying on the field. Nope, they're calling him over. They're trying to mix it up a little bit.
Swinging gate.
Swinging gate to the near side, pass is incomplete. How deep does the playbook go for the Falcons?
Haskins' pass goes incomplete.
Well, like I said, it feels like it's at their best when it's at their most entertaining. And just that throw was just way too high for Aire.
So they made it look like they were pulling the offense off the field, but then they stopped, got everybody set, had the center just toss it back to Haskins. And he tried to find Aire, and you see there, he is not happy with himself. So they bring everybody over, line everybody up real quick. It's a bit of a high snap. Haskins has to pull it down, and then the pass for Aire is way too tall.
Just a matter of one thing leading to another there. The high snap leads to the high pressure, which leads to the rushed throw that's way too high.
But, you know,
maybe one domino, take that out of the equation, the other dominoes don't fall, and you have another successful trick play.
Andrew Winningham.
Simpson got the carry on first down for Westfield State.
Second and 6.
Gain of about 4.
I love them trying these things. It's just a shame when it doesn't work out just because, you know.
Yeah.
I think that could have gotten a first down. Just
you would much rather see them try that than actually kick it, which is what I thought they were doing for a moment there.
I mean, I wasn't expecting them to punt it on that play. I knew that something was going to happen. Just wasn't expecting that.
Second down, six. Play fake pass to the far side is incomplete. Intended for Anthony Franco. As we go a little bit deeper in the depth chart in terms of backs and receivers for Westfield State, they still have their, I guess you can call him the starting quarterback, Gabriel Fernandez. He started the game after all. A little bit surprised. I would be surprised, Dan, if we don't see Peyton Capizzi in this game at all, just because it is a three-score game. It is the last game of the senior season for Capizzi. But we'll see. Could be an injury situation we don't know about, too. That's possible.
Looking at the sideline, he is there. He doesn't have his helmet on, though.
That's not a good sign. Also not a good sign for Westfield State is Fernandez going down hard. Couple different Falcons coming in with the sack. Stop me if you've heard these names before, Dan. It's Andrew Winningham and Cam Manette. I feel like we've called them those names a lot today.
Sort of those leaders on defense in terms of just getting out there. I want to see how many tackles do we have them in for now.
Logan Perez there as well for the Falcons. I think Luke Noyes would have gotten credit for half a sack if Perez didn't shove him out of the way and make the first hit. Perez is actually a little bit shaken up. He'll be taken off the field and tended to.
Manette and Winningham each have three tackles for a loss. Manette with eight tackles, tied for the team lead with Burmester and Wise.
Fourth down now, coming
in on. The sack on third down sets up fourth. Westfield State will kick it away.
Westfield already converted a fourth and long on a fake punt.
This time it's a short angled kick. It's going to go out of bounds at maybe the 35-yard line. That was like a 10-yard punt.
That was a shank.
I think they were going for the angle, but they were, you know, trying to get, you know, the coffin corner rather than just, yeah, get it out of bounds.
Yeah. That was just Locking a bad misfire off the foot of Clark. I think he did want that coffin corner. He had every intention of kicking it out of bounds, just not at that spot. Like maybe 30 yards farther downfield. Or I guess in this case, 20 yards farther downfield. 30 yards would put you in the end zone.
That's true. That would have been bad. Also bad is spotting the ball at the Falcon 29-yard line. So that's where Fitchburg State will take over. First and 10 for them. 7:12 to play here in the fourth quarter. Justin Stanford is in the game. Three receivers for the Falcons. Haskins quick drop, rolls to his right. Throws over the middle, passes low and incomplete. He was trying to hit Tim O'Neill. Pass was a little bit to O'Neill's left. Also, he was whacked as the ball came in, but for once, there is no yellow handkerchief on the field.
It was a bit short as well, I do believe. Think about how roles have changed. The last time these two teams played, Haskins was the leading receiver for the Falcons.
Now second down 10, Haskins pumps, rolls to his right again, under pressure. He's gonna take off with himself, scrambles forward. Don't think he got back to the line of scrimmage. No, they will mark it as about a 4-yard loss, in fact. So the negative quarterback scramble pushes the Falcons back. It'll be fourth and 14. As you see number 14 getting signals from the sideline.
Third down.
Third and 14.
I did say fourth and 14, didn't I?
Yep. Well, when you lose 4 yards in a play like that, it feels like it's like it was two downs. I'm just trying to cover.
Thank you. Play action fake. Haskins throws to the right. Wide open is Aire. He's got the ball into Owl territory. That's good for a Fitchburg first down.
Doesn't matter what the down was. Aire will happily take that.
Matty Aguirre with a good catch and run gets the Fitchburg offense into Westfield territory. Booyaka, Booyaka, 6:19 to play here in the fourth quarter, first and 10 Falcons. Kimball in motion, play fake by Haskins. Throws to the right for Kimball, incomplete, a little bit long. You can see Kimball asking for a penalty flag. And really, Dan, after the officials had the coaches take their teams aside, the chippiness has gone down a lot. I think that's something that the officiating crew should be commended for here.
Yeah, but sometimes it's something like that that really does make a difference. I remember many years ago in rugby union, the great Nigel Owens took the entire teams aside and gave a big speech telling them, you're all adults, you'll be treated like them as long as you behave like them.
Second down pass is incomplete, and I think I may have jinxed something. It was a big hit right as the ball came in. I believe it was William Soto who delivered it. And the most incredible thing has happened. A gentleman has thrown a yellow handkerchief onto the playing surface. The hit came, I mean, okay, here's what happened. The ball hit the receiver's hands. He was looking for Kimball. It hit Kimball's hands, and then the hit came in.
There's no foul on the play.
I think it is correct to wave the flag off. You see, the Westfield fans are happy about that. But
that's waved off flag number four today, by the way. And maybe that could have also been influenced by Kimball asking for a penalty on the previous play. You look out for it a little more, you think you may have seen something, you throw the flag there, and as it turns out, upon discussion with alternative opinions, you conclude, okay, that wasn't actually an infraction.
And you see there Scott Sperone getting the explanation from our official. You can see him putting his hands together as if to say, it was bang, bang, it was right there. And watching live, it looked like a hard hit, but it was a clean hit. It was right there. I do think it was the correct call to not enforce a penalty there.
Kimball has taken a beating out there today on his senior day, the graduate student from Bow, New Hampshire. But he's been doing a lot, working a lot with the offense.
Now on 3rd and 10, Haskins rolls to his left under pressure. He will get dragged down out of bounds.
Haskins keeps.
Westfield State very happy with themselves after that stop.
Loss of about 5, and Haskins just rolling, looking. May have been a coverage sack, essentially. Just didn't have the opportunity to throw to anybody.
You can hear players on, I think it's the Falcons sideline, asking, why are we punting? Which, I mean, is a reasonable question, although it is 4th and 15, so. Punt team on the field for Fitchburg. Haskins rolls to his right, gets away a good punt. That's a booming kick that bounces at the 10, and unfortunately will go into the end zone. But it's still going to be a net of 35, 40 yards. It was a really good, strong kick by Joe Haskins. One of his better punts, Dan.
It's definitely one of his best ones on the season. What is his long for the year? 58, well, yes, 58 is long. Couldn't have been 58 because there was only, I think, 54 he could have gotten, but.
It was close to that. But, you know, 20 of it will come back due to the touchback.
May have thought about it for a moment, but didn't like any of his options downfield. Just took the safe option.
Westfield State's offense back on the field. First down handoff goes to Blake Simpson. He breaks through straight through the middle, going to the far sideline. He's got one man to beat. It's D. Jones, and Jones is able to drag him down, but not before he gets to the Falcon 21-yard line. A 49-yard run for Blake Simpson. That was a huge gain here. Take a look at it again. Just waits for something to develop, finds the hole straight up the middle, and then he's into the second level. D. Jones was the only guy who could catch him, and he did do that. But it's a big, big gain for Simpson. Officially, it'll be a 48-yard run. They spot him at the 22. But a big run there for the freshman from Bellingham. He gets it again on first down, plunges across the 20 to about the 19-yard line.
Simpson, gain of 3.
We've seen a number of ball carriers have success today for Westfield State. They started off with Shane Clark and Lee Cologne. Justin Jean Charles got in. Now Blake Simpson has done a lot of the running. And all of this, Dan, has been without the man who has been coming into today, their leading rusher, O.T. Thomas. He hasn't seen the field at all.
Haven't seen him out there, and looking at these full stats on the season, Simpson came in with no career attempts.
Well, he has some career attempts today, and he's doing pretty darn well. Now on second down, he bounces it out to the right side. He's very close to the line to gain.
Simpson.
I think they're going to stop the clock, move the chains.
Time for now at the Fitchburg hit.
It is a first down.
First down yardage on the play.
It'll be first and 10 for the Owls. Looks like it's at the Fitchburg 12-yard line. As we go under 3:45 to play here on Senior Day. Westfield State looking for a score to salt this one away or just keep the clock running. Now fumble on the snap. Fernandez dives forward.
Turn on the exchange.
And we've been very impressed with Westfield's play today, Dan, but there are definitely things for them to work on as, you know, the players who are returning next season. It's, you know, ball handling needs work, special teams, just anything under that umbrella, I would say, needs work. But this is a pretty good team they got here.
They've got some solid young players on this roster. As long as Fernandez continues to improve, Westfield could very much be a player in the years to come.
I don't think this is going to be a one-win team next season, based on the way they're playing today. Second down handoff goes to Simpson. Gets to about the 10-yard line. And we'll stop the clock for a timeout.
Owls Saint had the Fitchburg State hit.
While I have a moment, I've compiled a list of all the other teams in D3 who entered today winless.
Okay.
So let's use these up.
Yes.
So Alvernia, the Golden Wolves out of Pennsylvania, were 0-9. Hosting Lycoming today, a 6-3 team, Alvernia in their third varsity season. Beloit out of Wisconsin, 0-9, hosting Illinois College. Three consecutive one-win seasons. They could make it four with a win, but challenging against an Illinois College team, the Blue Boys, I think, 4-5. Buffalo State, 0-9. They're hosting St. Lawrence. If they get the win, it'll be their third straight 1-9 season. Finlandia is at Olivet in their sixth varsity season. They were winless the last two seasons as well. Greensboro, the pride of North Carolina, 1-9 their last four seasons, hosting Maryville of Tennessee, a 3-6 team. Keystone, the Giants in their first varsity season, 0-10. Happens sometimes. The Norse of Luther out of Decorah, Iowa. They have a blue field, but they were feeling blue at the end of the season, an 0-10 record, first winless season in 9 years for them after two straight 1-9 seasons. Puget Sound, the Loggers in the Northwest Conference, hosting Willamette today. Willamette 1-8, their only win against Puget Sound to open the season.
So Fitchburg State not alone in Division III football in terms of going 0-10. Oh, Freddie. Oh, no. Oh, poor Freddie. Freddie the Falcon not having a good day. No Falcons having good days.
Blake Simpson.
Simpson got the carry, plunged up the middle. Falcons take a second timeout, but no, Freddie and the duffel bag, we're not getting along there, Dan.
Yeah. I only saw it at the end. I wasn't looking at the monitor.
It didn't go well for him.
Well, let's get the rest of these in here.
Shall we?
All right. Sewanee, the University of the South, the Tigers, 0-9, hosting 2-7 Hendricks today.
I'm sorry, the University of the South?
I believe that's what they like to refer to themselves as.
The entire South? There are good football players in the South. How is the South 0-10?
Good question. St. Scholastica, the Saints, the replacement for St. Thomas in the MIAC, 0-7, playing Hamlin today. They were supposed to play Sewanee in week one. That didn't happen. Someone would have preferred that to have happened. The Tomcats of Teal out of Greenville, Pennsylvania.
Not Peter Teal. They're better than that.
0-9, hosting Ben Palaszczuk's old team, Grove City, trying to avoid their third straight winless season. And last but not least, the Poets of Whittier out of Whittier, California, went 0-9 this year. It's their fourth winless season in the last 6 years after a 1-8 and 2-7 season in 2018 and 19. 2015, 16, 17, no wins there. Unfortunately, Poets couldn't find any this year either.
Well, you know,
fourth down.
It's hard when you can't write your own stories. Fourth down now upcoming for Westfield. They can get a first down without getting the touchdown. They try it with a pitch to Simpson to the near side. He lunges forward, extends. He's got the first down, but he's down inside the two. So it will be first and goal for Westfield State.
2:30 left and one timeout. They can't just kneel it out, so. no other option really but to just go for it, I would
just
say.
Just keep going. Might as well.
Al's first and goal.
Fitchburg State had been calling timeouts, trying to get the ball back. Westfield State taking as much time as they can. But they will hand it off first and goal. Simpson plunges straight up the middle. He is in. Touchdown, Owls.
1 yard touchdown.
And that's the tee. You can count Fitchburg State out.
Blake Simpson didn't have a carry coming in, the freshman from Bellingham. But the Blackhawk switching his feathers for another, finding his first collegiate touchdown.
And Westfield State will go back to the extra point game, which I think they've made one today.
Just one.
Well, Danny Farrell will make it two. So with 2:03 to play here, Westfield State leads 38-13. They will kick it back to the Falcons, and Fitchburg's offense will get one more shot as they try to put some points on the board. Well, some more points, rather. And hey, you know,
Don,
what, Dan?
The most incredible thing has happened.
Has a gentleman thrown a yellow handkerchief onto the playing surface?
He sure has.
My goodness.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct on the defense, number 99. Unsportsmanlike conduct on the offense, number 52. Those penalties all set. The try is good. Kickoff at the 35.
So I believe it is Jaron Hickey of Westfield State and Logan Perez of Fitchburg State guilty of some unsportsmanlike conduct. And pretty much since I said, oh, by the way, that talking to really worked, the talking to has stopped working. So that's unfortunate. But one thing I did notice, Dan, and I didn't realize this at the time, I was right. Both teams did get to double digits today.
They did make it there.
I did call that, so.
Obviously, Westfield having the day of their season. 38 points for them. Beats the 30 that they put up against Worcester.
Christian Jillian, take it away.
So this could very well be the last kickoff of the game. The Falcons, we'll see if they have a retort to that comment.
Short kick bounces at the 40, and this time the Falcons will let it go out of bounds.
Kick goes out of bounds.
So they should have a pretty good field position. You know, Dan, the most incredible thing is about to happen. I believe a gentleman is just going to gently drop a yellow handkerchief onto the field.
Out of bounds on the kicking team. The ball will be placed at the 35-yard line, first down.
The ball will be placed 30 yards from the kickoff. And yes, that's one of those things, though, where you don't have a choice. You have to throw the yellow handkerchief. That yellow handkerchief has gotten a lot of work today. How many pellets?
It's going to need laundering.
How many rubber pellets are going to end up in that yellow handkerchief today?
It's been busy. Fortunately, everybody has one, but even still, they're all going to need a bath.
It's the last game of the year for those, unless, you know, there's some working high school, or if there are some working playoff games starting next week.
Askins back to pass on first down. Under pressure, rolls to his right. Just chucks it in the general direction of Mack Kimble. General enough that they credit him as an intended receiver there. It's an incomplete pass.
Is it even worth throwing the yellow handkerchief for that?
He was outside the pocket. There was a guy kind of near it. I think that's one where you just kind of say, okay, fine.
Yep, it's fine, it's fine.
You were trying to get to that guy, sure. We will all agree that that is what was the intent there. We'll call it second down. Let's keep moving here. Second down, 10 for the Falcons. Play fake to Stanford. Haskins will throw to his left this time. Had to stretch out, but he did make the catch, did Mack Kimble. Into Westfield territory. Move the chains for the Falcons at the Westfield 45-yard line. So Fitchburg State's offense wants to close out their season with one more score.
Chris West had the tackle for Westfield. Falcons
take another look at this one.
From the Owl 45.
He was looking to the left the whole time. Wasn't the prettiest pass, but he got there. Kimball did a good job getting yards after the catch. Now on first down, pass to the near side is complete. Aire gets out of one tackle, blows a tire as he crosses the 35-yard line, but that's another Fitchburg first down. 1:40 to play as the clock stops. Falcons have one timeout. Plenty of time for them. They need to move, you know, with alacrity, but they don't need to hurry. First and 10, Falcons at the Owl 34-yard line. Haskins takes the snap, throws to his left side. That pass is incomplete. He was looking for Kimball in the flat. Pass was a little too long for him, but it will stop the clock with 1:24 to play here in the fourth quarter.
Just felt like it came out of his hands weird. And Aguirre on that previous play, sort of diving and stumbling across the 35. At that point, the marker was on the 35. He knew that line. He gets that line gained, essentially. He knows he's going to be able to stop the clock and move the chains.
Incomplete pass brings up second down. It'll be second and 10 for the Falcons. They're at the Westfield 34. Justin Stanford remains in the backfield. Three wide receivers for the Falcons, one tight end. Haskins under pressure, rolls to his left, wants to throw to his left. He's got a man. Aire is there. He's got it at the 20 and is dragged down inside the 15. Move the chains for another Fitchburg first down. It'll be first and 10 Falcons from the Westfield 13-yard line. And Matty Aire is hurt. He is clutching at his right elbow. He needs to come out of this game. I don't think he wants to come out of this game, but he really should. He's going to line up as a tight end, though. First down handoff goes to Stanford. He bounces out of tackle, stiff arms a man, reverses field. He's going to be dragged down at the 10.
Gain of a couple.
The Falcons will take their final timeout.
Took basically half the team to tackle him there for Westfield. It's like 6-7 white shirts. So let's look at the replay there for Haskins' completion to Aguirre. You see wide focused open there on the far side.
He was wide open indeed on the far side. A nice catch and run for Matty Aguirre. Now Fitchburg State's offense has 48 seconds to figure out how to get the ball into the end zone. They have second down and 7 from the 10-yard line. This is the handoff to Stanford on the last first down play. You can see there someone's trying to drag him down from the left arm. Stanford finally shakes him, but it takes three more Owls. Now the officials have put another 5 seconds on the clock, so there's 53 seconds for Fitchburg State. If they're stopped inbounds here on second down, they can spike it on third and still have a fourth down play. That is an option for them. Second and 7 from the 10. Haskins floats one up for the back corner of the end zone, swatted down, incomplete. He was trying to find Gabe Mangrum.
Not sure if Mangrum would have been able to haul that in inbounds. He was using all of the space there in the end zone.
It was a very deep floater for the back corner.
Swatted down there, I think, by Laguerre.
It sounds about right.
29 or 28?
Well, 28 is Swinehart. He's listed as a receiver, so let's go with Laguerre.
Freshman from Bedford. His Buccaneers got knocked out by Grafton last night.
Now on third down, fake the pitch. Haskins rolls to his right, pass is caught by Stanford. He's across the 5. Justin Stanford is in. His second touchdown of the day. Touchdown, Falcons.
Now Stanford's got a touchdown reception to his credit. Again, did he really think coming in he was going to end up playing such a big role in the offense
just
down the draft?
Just like they drew it up, Dan. You get a freshman transfer from Georgia, you convert him to your lead tailback, and then you hit him for 2 scores on senior day. It's just like they drew it up.
DeKeel's in to try to attempt the extra point.
Linnea DeKeel will attempt the extra point. Good snap, good hold. Her kick is up, and it is good. So on senior day, Linnea DeKeel gets an extra point. 38-20 the score. Fitchburg State has their best offensive performance of the season. Has the most incredible thing happened?
No.
Okay.
it was just the that Worcester game, as hard as it is to remember.
Didn't I say at home? I meant to say at home.
Yeah, at home is what you meant to say.
Those did I not say at home? I meant to say at home. Dang it.
But still, really enjoyed what I saw out of Justin Stanford today, though.
Dan, do you remember when I used to be good at this job? I used to be good at this job.
You still are. We all have our slip-ups. I badly butchered a guy's name earlier today.
I'm sure we all did. But yes, a big day, a coming out party almost, on senior day for the freshman Justin Stanford. You know, I know we've said earlier there's going to be a lot of change on this Falcon team. He may not be the main weapon in the backfield, but they really do have something there with Justin Stanford. It would be a shame if he's not part of the offensive game plan going into the 2022 season.
Now, a little bit of inside baseball was, you know, earlier this year, I went in during the media day, I went and covered that by recording everybody introducing themselves, saying their names, how they pronounce it, if they had any nicknames. I know he had the most nicknames, for one thing, but also he just had so much charisma and he so enjoyed being here. We'll try the onside kick again.
This one bounces loose and the Falcons have it. So don't go ending that season just yet. Fitchburg State recovers the onside kick. They'll try to get it back in the end zone one more time before we call it quits on the 2021 campaign.
Well, they got one successful onside kick in today. And it was Jordan Dickerson, J-Genis 2.0. Maybe next season I'll ask him what the significance of that nickname is.
Maybe. Can do the same for Draco, Dunk, T. We really should have been using all of these nicknames for Stanford before now, but you know.
Yep, those were three of the many nicknames.
Askins play action fake pass to the far side is incomplete and then blown up. I think maybe you could get a little upset with that one, but they're not going to throw the flag. That was a massive hit delivered by Justin Gardner.
Kimball, the intended receiver.
Matt Kimball got leveled again. Take a look at it again on the replay. It looked similar to the one where they threw a flag and then picked it up. That's honestly, you know, maybe it's just the replay and it's a little slowed down. I think that's a little bit more egregious, but that was a big hit by Gardner. But no flag comes out. Now on second down, Haskins rolls to his right. How far can he throw it? He chucks it deep for the end zone. Jump ball tipped and incomplete. He was trying to find Kimball. Was well covered by Daniel Ledoux. Chris West also in the area for the Owls.
Third and 10.
But for Fitchburg State right now, it's the last minute of the season for the senior quarterback and the rest of the seniors on the team. It's the last minute of their college careers. Just have some fun, chuck it deep a few times, see what happens.
That's, I think, the big thing. Just try to enjoy yourselves here in the last minute and take it all in.
Askins drops back on third down, rolls to his right. Throws for the near sideline. That pass is picked off. Returned out of bounds for a few yards there. Daniel O'Leary, first time we've called his name today. And that'll put an end to the offensive comeback for the Falcons. Westfield State is not going to go winless this season. The Owls will be 1-9. You see their fans appreciative of that. Owl offense has to come back out and take one more knee. But that'll see an end to this one.
Westfield, as we know, they were one play away from coming into this game with a record of 1-8, of avoiding the 0-9 versus 0-9 matchup. But it just gave them all the more motivation that they had to win this one. And the offense just rolling and rolling today. 414 yards of offense for the Owls. And they're one kneel down away from getting that golden victory.
Gabriel Fernandez takes the knee. The Falcons will see the clock run out on their season. 0-10 for Fitchburg State University. For Westfield, though, they managed to avoid that mark. 1-9. Congratulations to the Owls. This may not be the best team that we've seen hit Elliott Field, because there are some good teams in the MASCAC, but this team is not going to win just one game next year. Westfield's a pretty darn good team.
Indeed, and maybe Westfield, as you said, they may not have been the best team to come to Elliott Field this year, but at least for today, they were the ones who played the most above expectations.
38-20 is the final, and really, Dan, it was a disappointing season for the Falcons, but especially in these last two home games, you see, you know, there are some things to build on there. They were able to put points on the board. It's not completely without hope for a Fitchburg State side.
Yeah, and also, just looking through at the field, there's no, like, traditional handshake line here, probably due to the chippiness. It's just a matter of congregate a little bit, shake hands with who you want to shake hands with. You don't want to shake hands with them, that's whatever. And whatever. I did see Scott Sperone and Pete Kowalski come together, you know, with smiles on their faces. I mean, obviously, there was no frustration running through either of those gentlemen, no animosity between the two. But at least, you know, now that the game's over, everyone can take a breath and we can we'll think about the things they did right and the things they did wrong in the future. And obviously for the Falcons, it was a challenging season. 0-10, it's their first winless season since 1996. It's their first ever 0-10 season and their eighth winless season in program history. But as for the Falcons, you know, they know there's much to improve on. This was obviously a challenge for Coach Sperone coming in with the pandemic and all those other challenges that came in. It's basically building a new program from scratch.
I mean, yeah, you know, you go back to, I remember after the 2019 season, and the 2019 season was not a good season, for those who remember that. You know, there was very clearly a need for change at Fitchburg State with the football program, and that was coming in 2020, and then, you know, 2020 happened. And, you know, you couldn't play any football. You saw a lot of guys decide not to come back for 2021. And the guys who were here, you know, they played hard. They did their best. There were injuries up and down the line, guys being shifted in and out of position, you know. You know, you say it like a joke, you know, oh, big number 98 is the tailback. And, hey, you know, you might have found a decent little tailback in big number 98, Justin Stanford.
I mean, there was a point where he legitimately became the best option they had. And, you know, he proved his worth today. Touched 16 carries, 65 yards, and a touchdown, and he had that 9-yard touchdown catch as well. A tremendous day for him. Joe Haskins finishes his final game 8-24, 107 yards, 2 touchdowns through the air, and 1 pick. Matt Kimball gets a 34-yard throw in his final collegiate game. Logan Wilson completed both his passes for 27 yards. Matty Aguirre had 3 catches for 59 yards and 5 carries for 27. He looked pretty solid out there as well. There's some positives to take away from this one. And of course, most of them are coming back.
Yeah, you know, Aguirre is a sophomore. We've mentioned Stanford, a freshman. Obviously, you know, it's simple, you know, reductive analysis. It starts with the quarterback position. The Falcons are going to need to find somebody there who can be the signal caller for the long term. Maybe that's Logan Wilson. He's a sophomore, presumably coming back next year for his junior season. Maybe that's somebody who's not presently on the team. Maybe that's coming. You know, we don't know where it's coming from, the Falcons, but that's where it's got to start offensively. On the defensive side of the ball, they've got some really impressive pieces. You know, we've been really impressed with the play of D. Jones. Obviously, you know, the Fitchburg high grad, there are a lot of strong standouts on that Fitchburg State defense. So it's a very frustrating season, as any 0-10 season would be, but there are some building blocks here.
Indeed, and obviously the O-line as well. They've got to get more numbers on the O-line, more size on the O-line. I was talking with Coach Sperone last week, and he was saying that's one of the things they have to work on, is they've got to get in the weight room. They've got to get stronger out there. Injuries were obviously a challenge. They had to move Jeremiah Watson from tight end to the O-line because they were that depleted in those spots. And that obviously leads to a challenge, because if your O-line is just getting beat like that because you're being outclassed, through circumstances that you prefer, that you can't exactly control necessarily. It doesn't give your quarterback or your running back much time to really do anything, and it makes it so much tougher to make the offense work. That's basically why Joe Haskins has such a low completion percentage. He finishes, like I said, 8 for 24 today, because he never gets the time to get passes off.
If, you know, we talked about, I mentioned, you know, it starts with the quarterback position, but you can have the best quarterback in the world. You know, you can have any quarterback you want from Falcon history. You could go, you know, all the way back to, you know, any, you could have Tom Brady there. If he doesn't have an offensive line, it doesn't matter. So the Falcon offensive line, the guys who are coming back, you know, need to step up, need to get healthy, need to get stronger. Guys that are coming in, they just need to bolster the line, really. And again, it's a work in progress. You've got a second-year head coach who's just finishing his first full season, and his first year on the job was, again, 2020. So there's some work to do, but it's going to be interesting to see how many guys who are on the team now come back for 2022 and just what the general game plan looks like in 2022. Because I think the offensive game plan that Coach Spurrone rolled out in 2021 was, these are the guys I have, and this is what I think I can do with them. Hopefully in 2022 we see them, you know, open it up a little bit in terms of the formations and the play calling.
Yes, and I know I was talking with him at the beginning of the season. He said, we'll run the formations based on the personnel that we have that we think gives us the best chance for success. And we saw them out of the flex bone for so much, but that just goes to what they have at their disposal. We've seen them do some other formations, some other plays. I loved how the ingenuity continued to grow as the season went on.
Yeah, there are things you can do out of that formation. We saw that a little bit, you know, today with sending men in motion, sending guys in motion, faking the pitch, the handoffs there, running the option out of that. You saw a couple of times they toss to Kimble and then Kimble tries to throw it downfield. There are definitely things you can do, and it'll be interesting to see how many of those things Fitchburg State incorporates into their offense going forward. One more time, folks, before we get out of here, we want to thank our underwriters who make this and every broadcast possible. FATV's remote productions are underwritten by Workers Credit Union, Rollstone Bank and Trust, UMass Memorial Health, Health Alliance, Clinton Hospital, North End Subaru, Unitil, Minuteman Press, and the Sentinel and Enterprise.
And our crew today, Nate Glennie was our director, Travis Falk on audio and graphics and doing all the other little things behind the scenes. Todd Govan was on replay. Robin Como and Jared Roberts had the cameras up here, and Moritz Vetter and Kayla Jorgensen had the camera down there.
Fantastic work by the entire FATV crew. Folks, thank you so much for being here with us for the entire season of Fitchburg State football. Again, Fitchburg High School playing Algonquin today. That game will be coming up on FATV in the days to come. Go to fatv.org for a full up-to-the-minute schedule for that. But for Dan Bolak and the entire FATV crew, I'm John Gugarty saying thank you so much for watching, folks. We'll see you next time right here on FATV.